A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
Star Wars. Darth Maul, Shadow Hunter. Volume 3 of the Darth Maul Trilogy. By Michael Reaves. 2001. Read by Chuck Benson. Restored and remastered by The.Archivist Publishing. And now, the unabridged edition of the story.
An even longer time ago, in a galaxy far, far away. Part 1. Mean Streets. 1. Space is the perfect place to hide. The Nemoidian freighter, Sakak, cruised ponderously in the uncharted deeps of wild space. It displayed its colors proudly, its cloaking device disabled, with no fear of detection. Here, parsecs away from the civilized galactic core and its surrounding systems, it could safely hide in plain sight. Even the Nemoidians, those past masters of paranoia, felt secure in the vast, endless abyss between the disk and one of the spiral arms. Yet even here, the leaders of the Trade Federation could not entirely let go of their natural tendency toward subterfuge. They sought duplicity and guile, the way a young grub seeks the safety and warmth of its sleeping niche in the communal hive. The Sakak was a good example of this. It was, to all appearances, merely a commercial vessel, its horseshoe shape designed to carry large amounts of cargo. Not until an unwary enemy had come within firing range would the heavy durasteel armor plating, blaster turrets, and military strength communications arrays become visible. By which time, of course, it would be too late. Aboard the Sakak's bridge, all was silent, save for the muted beeps and chimes of various life support monitors, and the almost inaudible susurrus of the air filtration system. Three figures stood to one side of the huge transparisteel viewport. They wore the flowing robes and mantles of the Nemoidian aristocracy, but their body language, as a fourth figure appeared in their midst, was deferential, if not outright cringing and servile. The fourth figure was not really there with them in any physical sense. The robed and hooded form was a holograph, a three-dimensional image projected from an unknown source light-years distant. Intangible and immaterial, the mysterious stooped image nevertheless dominated the three Nemoidians. Indeed, they could not have been any more thoroughly cowed had he been physically present with a blaster in each hand. The figure's face, what little was visible of it in the shadows of the hood, was grim and unforgiving. The cowled head moved slightly as he looked at each of the Nemoidians in turn. Then the figure spoke, his voice a dry rasp, his tone that of one accustomed to instant obedience. "There are only three of you." The tallest of the three, the one wearing the triple-crested tiara of a viceroy, responded in a stammering voice. "That is true, Lord Sidious. I see you, Gunray, and your lackeys Hakko and Dauphine. Where is the fourth one? Where is Monchar?" Federation Viceroy Newt Gunray clasped his hands in front of him in what was not so much a supplicating gesture as an attempt to keep them from nervously wringing each other. He had hoped he would grow used to dealing with the Sith Lord over time, but so far that had not happened. If anything, These meetings with Darth Sidious had become even more gut-twisting and upsetting as the deadline for the embargo grew ever closer. Gunray did not know how his seconds in command, Dalte Dauphine and Rune Hacko, felt. Discussing one's feelings was anathema in Nemoidian society, but he knew how he felt after each encounter with the Sith Lord. He felt like squirming back into his Hive Mother's birth chamber and pulling the cloacal flap in after him. Especially now. Curse hath Monchar. Where was the misbegotten rankweed sucker? Not on board the Sokak, that much was certain. The ship had been searched from the center sphere to the airlocks at the outmost ends of each docking bay arm. Not only was his deputy viceroy nowhere to be found, but a scout vessel with hyperdrive capability was missing as well. Put these two facts together, and the chances of Viceroy Gunray winding up as fodder for one of the fungus farms back on Nemoidia was beginning to look distressingly good. The holographic image of Darth Sidious flickered slightly, then regained its none-too-stable resolution. A glitch, most likely caused by some solar flare, on a star between here and whatever mysterious world the signal was originating from. Not for the first time, Gunray found himself wondering on what world or ship the real Sith was standing. And not for the first time, he flinched hastily away from the thought. He didn't want to know too much about the Nemoidian's ally in this undertaking. In fact, he wished he could forget what little he already knew. Collaborating with Darth Sidious was about as safe as being trapped in a cave on Tatooine with a hungry crate dragon. The hooded face turned to glare directly at him. "Well?" Sidious demanded. Even as he opened his mouth, Gunray knew that it would be futile to lie. The Sith Lord was a master of the Force, that mysterious and pervasive energy field that, some said, knitted the galaxy together just as surely as did gravity. Sidious might not be able to read another's inmost thoughts, but he certainly could tell when someone was lying. Even knowing that, however, the Nemoidian could no more stop himself from dissimulating than he could stop his sweat ducts from oozing oily perspiration down the back of his neck. "He was taken ill, my lord. Too much rich food. He has a delicate constitution." Gunray closed his mouth, keeping his lips firmly pressed together to stop them from trembling. Inwardly he cursed himself. Such a pathetic and obvious prevarication. Even a Gamorrean would be able to see through it. He waited for Sidious to command Hacko and Dauphine to turn on him to strip him of his vestments and rank. He had no doubt that they would do it. For the Nemoidians, one of the most difficult concepts to understand in the galactic lexicon of basic was the word loyalty. However, to his astonishment, Sidious merely nodded instead of showering him with vituperation. "I see. Very well, then. The four of us shall discuss the contingency plans should the trade embargo fail. Monchar can be briefed on them when he recovers." The Sith Lord continued speaking, describing his plan to hide a large secret army of battle droids in the cargo bays of the trade ships, but Gunray could hardly pay attention to the specifics. He was stunned that his desperate ruse had worked. The Viceroy's relief was short-lived, however. He knew that at best all he had done was buy some time, and not much of that. When Sidious's hologram again materialized on the bridge of the Sokak, he would once more demand to know where Monchar was, and this time he would not accept illness as an excuse. There were no two ways about it. His errant lieutenant would have to be found, and quickly. But how to do this without arousing Sidious's suspicions? Gunray felt certain at times that the Sith Lord was somehow able to peer into every compartment, niche, and cubicle on the freighter, that he knew everything, no matter how trivial or inconsequential, that took place on board. The Viceroy silently commanded himself to maintain control. He took advantage of Sidious's attention, being momentarily focused on Hacko and Dauphine, to surreptitiously slip an anti-stress capsule between his lips. He could feel his lung pods expanding and contracting convulsively within him, on the verge of hyperventilation. an old saying characterized Nemordians as the only sentient species with an entire organ devoted solely to the task of worrying. As Newt Gunray felt the anxiety that had been momentarily quelled threatening to build up once more in his gut sack, the adage did seem to have an unpleasant ring of truth to it. Darth Sidious, Master of the Sith, finished relaying his instructions to the Nemoidians and made a slight, almost negligent gesture. Across the room, a relay clicked and the holographic transmission ended. The flickering blue-white images of the Nemoidians and the section of their ship's bridge captured by the split-beam transceivers vanished. Sidious stood motionless and silent on the transmission grid, his fingers steepled, his mind meditating on the eddies and currents of the Force. Those of lesser sensitivity were oblivious to it, but to him it was like an omnipresent mist, invisible but nonetheless tangible, that swirled and drifted constantly about him. No words, no descriptions could begin to convey what it was like. The only way to understand it was to experience it. He had learned over long years of study and meditation how to interpret each and every vagary of its restless flow, no matter how slight. Even without that ability, however, he would have known that Newt Gunray was lying about Hath Monchar's whereabouts. An old joke about the Viceroy's kind summed it up nicely. How can you tell if a Nemoidian is lying? His mouth is open. Sidious nodded slightly. There was no doubt of Gunray's dishonesty. The only question was why. It was a question that had to be answered, and soon. The Nemoidians were weaklings, true enough, but even the most cowardly creatures would rear up on their hind legs and bite if sufficiently motivated. They were plotting behind his back. To believe otherwise was to be hopelessly naive. And, though a great many crimes could be laid at Darth Sidious's feet, naivete was certainly not one of them. Given how potentially important the Naboo embargo and subsequent economic machinations could be, there was really only one thing to do. Sidious made another slight gesture. The Force rippled in response, and the transmission grid beneath his feet glowed again. A holograph of himself was once more sent racing through the void to another remote location. It was time to bring a new player into the game, one who had trained and studied for years for precisely this kind of assignment, the one who comprised the other half of the Sith Order. His protege, his disciple, his myrmidon. The one Sidious had named Darth Maul. The dueling droids were programmed to kill. There were four of them, top-of-the-line duelist elites from Trong Robotics, all armed in different ways, one with a steel rapier, one with a heavy cudgel, the third with a short length of chain, and the last with a pair of double-edged hachette fighting blades as long and wide as a human's forearm. They had been programmed with the skills of a dozen martial arts masters, and their reflexes were calibrated just a hair faster than human optimum. Their Durasteel chassis were blaster-resistant. They had come factory-equipped with behavioral inhibitors that prevented them from delivering a death blow once their opponent had been beaten, but these inhibitors had been nullified by their new owner. A mistake against one would be fatal. Darth Maul did not make mistakes. The Sith apprentice stood in the middle of the training chamber as the four droids circled him. His breathing was calm, his heartbeat even and slow. He was aware of his body's reactions to the danger. Aware and in control. Two of the droids, Rapier and Chain, he silently named them, were within his field of vision. The other two, Cudgel and Hachette, were not being behind him. It did not matter. Through his awareness of the Force, he could sense their movements as plainly as if he had eyes in the back of his head. Maul raised his own weapon, the double-bladed lightsaber, and triggered the power control. Twin lances of pure energy boiled forth, hissing and crackling in crimson loops that began and ended at the two flux apertures of either end of the device. Any Jedi Knight could wield a single-bladed lightsaber. Only a master fighter could use the weapon first designed by the legendary Dark Lord Exar Kun millennia ago. Unless one was in perfect attunement with it, the weapon could be as deadly to the user as to the opponent. Rapier lunged at full extension, its metal knee joint bent almost to the floor. The needle point flickered toward Maul's heart, almost too fast to see. The dark side blossomed in Darth Maul, the power of it resonating in him like black lightning, augmenting his years of training, guiding his reactions. Time seemed to slow, to stretch. It would have been easy to chop the blade itself in half, as few metals could resist the frictionless edge of a lightsaber. But there was no challenge to that. Maul spun toward the point, twisted around the outside, and snapped his hands horizontally at chest level. The left blade of the lightsaber sheared through Rapier's sword arm. Both arm and weapon clattered to the floor. Maul dropped to his left knee as, from directly behind him, Cudgel's full swing whistled over his head, barely missing his dorsal horn. Without looking, guided by the vibrations of the Force, he thrust backwards with the right blade, then forward with the left, 1-2, skewering both Cudgel and Rapier in their abdominal compartments. Sparks spewed from shorted circuitry, and lubricating fluid sprayed in a reddish, oily mist. Using the momentum of the forward thrust, Maul dived over the collapsing droid before him, flowing smoothly into a shoulder roll. He came up twirling his lightsaber overhead, then stepped down solidly into the Terras Kasi wide stance called Riding Bantha. Even as he did the movement, part of him was monitoring his body's state. His breathing was slow and even, his pulse elevated by no more than 2 or 3 beats per minute from its resting rate. 2 down, 2 to go. Chain charged, its weapon whirling over its head like the propeller of a gyrocraft. The heavy links lashed toward him. Maul spun on his right foot and shot his left leg out in a powerful side kick, slamming his boot into the droid's armored chest, stopping it cold. He dropped into a squat, spun the lightsaber like a scythe, and sickled the droid cleanly at the knees. Lower legs gone, it collapsed as Maul again twisted himself and his weapon, flowing into the form known as Rancor Rising. He brought the right blade up between Chain's mechanical thighs, hard, using his leg muscles to augment the strike as he pushed up from the squat to a standing position. The force of his strike bisected Chain from its crotch right through the top of its head. There was a hard metallic screech as the droid came apart in 2 halves. Its feet and lower legs hit the floor slightly before the upper halves landed atop them. The acrid smell of burned lubricating fluid and circuitry washed over Maul. What was, seconds ago, a functional piece of high-tech equipment was now a barely recognizable pile of scrap metal. 3 down, 1 to go. Hachette moved to Maul's left, whirling its razor-edged blades in defensive movements, high, low, left, right, a blinding pattern of edged death waiting to blind the unwary and cut him down. Maul allowed himself a twitch of his lips. He pressed the lightsaber's controls. The humming died as the energy beams blinked out. He bent, keeping his eyes on the droid as he put the weapon on the floor and shoved it away with his boot. He settled himself into a low defensive stance, angled toward the droid at 45 degrees, left foot forward. He watched the flickering arabesque of death as Hachette edged toward him. A droid like this knew no fear, but Darth Maul knew that to put his weapon down and face a live opponent barehanded would certainly terrify anybody brighter than a dueling droid. Fear was as potent a weapon as a lightsaber or a blaster. The dark side raged inside him, sought to blind him with hatred, but he held it at bay. He held one open hand high, by his ear, the other by his hip, then reversed the positions, watching, waiting. Hachette stole forward another half-step, crossing and recrossing the blades, looking for an opening. Maul gave the droid what it was looking for. He moved his left arm wide away from his body, exposing his side to a thrust or a cut. Hachette saw the opening and moved in fast, very fast, snapping one of the blades out to cut while bringing the other blade over for backup. Maul dropped, hooked his left foot around the back of the droid's ankle, and pulled as he kicked hard at the droid's thigh with the other foot. The droid fell backwards, unable to maintain its balance, and hit the floor. Maul sprang up, did a front flip, and came down with both boot heels driving into the droid's head. The metal skull crunched and collapsed inward. Lights flashed, and the hard shell photoreceptors shattered. Maul dived again, rolled up in a half-twist into the Foradari stance, ready to spring in any direction. But there was no need. These four were done. It would take a technician days to repair hachette, cudgel, and rapier. Chain was beyond repair, useful only for parts. Darth Maul exhaled, relaxed his stance, and nodded. His heart rate had accelerated perhaps 5 beats above normal at most. There was the faintest sheen of perspiration on his forehead. Otherwise, his skin was dry. Perhaps 60 seconds had elapsed from start to finish. Maul frowned slightly, not his personal best by any means. It was one thing to face and defeat droids. Jedi were a different matter. He would have to do better. He picked up his lightsaber, hung it from his belt. Then, his muscles warmed up now, he went to practice his fighting exercises. He had barely gotten more than a few meters, however, when a familiar shimmering in the air in front of him brought him to a stop. Before the hooded figure's image had time to solidify, Maul dropped to one knee and bowed his head. "Master," he said, "what do you wish of your servant?" The Sith Lord regarded his apprentice. "I am pleased with the way you dealt with the Black Sun assignment. The organization will be in disarray for years." Maul nodded slightly in acknowledgement. Such offhanded praise was the most he ever got in recognition of his work, and that only rarely. But praise, even from Sidious, did not matter. All that mattered was serving his master. "Now I have another task for you." "Whatever my master wishes shall be done. Hath Monchar, one of the four Nemoidians I am dealing with, has disappeared. I suspect treachery. Find him. Make sure he has spoken to no one of the impending embargo. If he has, kill him and everyone he has spoken to." The holographic image faded away. Maul straightened and headed for the door. His step was firm, his manner confident. Anyone else, even a Jedi, might have protested that such an assignment was impossible. It was a big galaxy, after all. But failure was not an option to Darth Maul. It was not even a concept. 2. Coruscant. The name evoked the same image in the mind of nearly every civilized being in the galaxy. Coruscant, bright center of the universe, cynosure of all inhabited worlds. Crown jewel of the core systems. Coruscant, seat of government for the myriad worlds of an entire galaxy. Coruscant, the epitome of culture and learning, synthesis of a million different civilizations. Coruscant. Seeing the planet from orbit was the only way to fully appreciate the enormity of the construction. Practically all of Coruscant's landmass, which comprised almost all of its surface area, its oceans and seas having been drained or rerouted through huge subterranean caverns more than 1,000 generations ago, was covered with a multi-tiered metropolis composed of towers, monads, ziggurats, palazzi, domes, and minarets. By day, the many cross-hatched levels of skycar traffic and the thousands of spaceships that entered and left its atmosphere almost blotted out views of the endless cityscape. But at night, Coruscant revealed its full splendor, outshining at close range even the spectacular nebulae and globular clusters of the nearby galactic core. The planet radiated so much heat energy that, were it not for thousands of strategically placed CO2 reactive dampers in the upper atmosphere, it would long ago have been transformed into a lifeless rock by a rampant atmospheric degeneration. An endless ring of titanic skyscrapers girded Coruscant around its equator, some of them tall enough to pierce the upper fringes of atmosphere. Similar, if shorter structures, could be found almost any place on the globe. It was those rarefied upper levels, spacious and clean, that constituted most people's conception of the galactic capital. But all visions of soaring beauty and wealth, no matter how stately, must be grounded somewhere, somehow. Along the equatorial strip, below the lowest stratum of air traffic, beneath the illuminated skywalks and the glittering facades, lay another view of Coruscant. There, sunlight never penetrated. The endless city night was lit only by flickering neon holoprojections, advertising sleazy attractions and shady businesses. Spider roaches and huge armored rats infested the shadows, and hawk bats, with wingspans of up to 1.5 meters, roosted in the rafters of deserted structures. This was the underbelly of Coruscant, unseen and unacknowledged by the wealthy, belonging solely to the disenfranchised and the damned. This was the part of Coruscant that Lorne Pavan called home. The meeting place had been suggested by the Toydarian. It was a dingy building at the back of a dead-end street. Lorne and his droid, I-5, had to step over a Rodian sleeping in a pile of rags near the recessed entrance.
"I've often wondered," the protocol droid said as they entered, "if your clientele all subscribe to the same service, the one listing the most disgusting and disreputable places in the galaxy to meet."
Lorne made no reply. He had wondered the same thing on occasion himself. Inside was a small lobby, most of its space taken up by a ticket booth made of yellowing plasteel. In the booth, a balding human male lounged in a form-fit chair. He looked up incuriously when they entered. "Booth 5's open," he grunted, jerking his thumb at one of the series of doors lining the lobby's circular wall. "One credit for a half hour." He looked at I-5, then said to Lorne, "If you're taking the droid in, you gotta sign a release form."
"We're here for Zippa," Lorne told him.
The proprietor glanced at them again, then shifted his bulk and pressed a button with a grimy finger. "Booth 9," he said. The hollow booth was even smaller than the lobby, which meant it was barely big enough to contain the four who were now crowded into it. Lorne and I-5 stood behind the single contour couch that faced the transmitter plate. Zippa hovered slightly above the plate, facing them, the sound of his rapidly beating wings providing a constant background buzz. The dim light darkened his mottled blue skin to an unhealthy shade of purplish black. Behind the Toydarian stood another, bulkier form. Lorne could tell that it was non-human, but the light was too faint for him to guess its species. He wished that Zippa would stop hovering. Whatever the being behind the Toydarian was, it stank like a silage bin at high noon, and the breeze generated by Zippa's wings wasn't helping matters any. It was obvious that Zippa hadn't been any too fastidious about bathing lately as well, but fortunately the Toydarian's body odor wasn't offensive. In fact, it reminded Lorne of sweet spice.
"Lorne Pavan," Zippa said, his voice somehow sounding faintly of static, as if it were tuned just a hair off true. "Good to see you again, my friend. It has been too long."
"Good to see you again, too, Zippa," Lorne replied, thinking, you really had to hand it to the old crook. Nobody could fake sincerity like he could. In reality, the best thing that could be said about Zippa was that he would never stab you in the back unless it was absolutely expedient. Zippa changed the angle of his wings slightly, rotating to one side as he gestured to the shadowy mass in the corner.
"This is Bilk, an associate of mine."
Bilk stepped forward slightly, and Lorne could now see him well enough to recognize him as a Gamorrean. That explained the stench.
"Pleased to meet you, Bilk." He gestured at I-5. "This is my associate, I-5YQ. I-5 for short."
"Charmed," I-5 said dryly. "Now, if you don't mind, I'll shut off my olfactory sensor before it overloads."
Zippa turned his bulbous gaze toward the droid.
"Chut-chut. A droid with a sense of humor. This I like. You want to sell him?"
The Toydarian drifted closer and slightly higher, the better to evaluate I-5's worth.
"Looks pretty cobbled together. Are those Cybot G7 power bus cables? Haven't seen them used in years. Still, he might be worth something as a curiosity. I'll give you 50 creds for him."
Lorne kicked the droid in his lower left servo motor coupling before I-5 could voice an indignant protest.
"Thanks for the offer, but I-5's not mine to sell. We're business partners."
Zippa stared at Lorne for a moment, then broke into a wheezing laugh.
"You got a weird sense of humor, Lorne. I never know when you're kidding. Still, I like you."
Bilk suddenly narrowed his beady eyes and rumbled deep in his throat, leaning truculently toward I-5.
probably only just now realizing that the droid's earlier remark had been an insult, Lorne surmised. Gamorreans weren't the brightest species in the galaxy, not by several decimal places. Zippa drifted in front of his hulking bodyguard. "Relax, Bilk. We're all good friends here." He turned back toward Lorne. "My friend, this is your lucky day." The Toydarian dug knobby fingers into a pouch and pulled out a palm-sized crystal cube, which glowed a dull red in the semi-darkness of the booth. "What I have here is an authentic Jedi holocron, reliably chronon-dated to be 5,000 years old. This cube contains secrets of the ancient Jedi Knights." He held the cube at Lorne's eye level. "For an artifact such as this, you must agree that no price is too great. Nevertheless, all I am asking is a measly 20,000 credits." Lorne made no attempt to touch the object that the fence held before him. "Most interesting, and certainly a fair price," he said, "if it is what you claim it is." Zippa looked affronted. "Nift, you doubt my word?" Bilk growled and cracked one set of knuckles against the horny palm of his other hand. They sounded like bone snapping. "No, of course not. I'm sure you believe what you say is true. But there are many unscrupulous vendors out there, and even someone with your discerning eye might conceivably be taken in. All I'm asking for is a little empirical proof." Zippa twisted his snout into a grin, exposing teeth scrimshod with the remnants of his last meal. "And how do you propose we get this proof? A Jedi holocron can be activated only by someone who can use the Force. Is there something you're not telling me, Lorne? Are you perhaps a closet Jedi?" Lorne felt himself go cold. He stepped forward and grabbed Zippa by his fleek-skin vest, jerking the surprised Toydarian toward him. Bilk growled and lunged at Lorne, then stopped cold as a hair-thin laser beam scorched his scalp between his horns. "Settle down," I-5 said pleasantly, lowering the index finger from which the beam had fired. "And I won't have to show you the other special modifications I've had installed." Ignoring the face-off between the droid and the Gamorrean, Lorne spoke in a low voice to Zippa. "I know that was intended as a joke, which is why I'm letting you live. But don't ever, ever say anything like that to me again." He glared into the Toydarian's protruding watery eyes for a moment longer, then released him. Zippa quickly assumed a position just behind Bilk, wings beating harder than ever. Lorne could see him swallow the surprise and anger he was undoubtedly feeling as he smoothed away the wrinkles in his vest. Inwardly, Lorne cursed himself. He knew it was a mistake to let his temper get the best of him. He needed this deal. He couldn't afford to antagonize the Toydarian fence. But Zippa's remark had taken him by surprise. "Touched a nerve, looks like," Zippa said. During the altercation, he had held on to the holocron. Now he stuffed it back into his belt pouch. "I didn't know I was dealing with someone so temperamental. Maybe I should find another buyer." "Maybe," Lorne replied. "And maybe I should just take the cube and pay you what it's worth, which I figure is about 5,000 creds. He saw Zippa's cavernous nostrils flare. The Toydarian couldn't resist bargaining, even with someone who had laid hands on him.
5,000? Fa! First you assault me, then you insult me. 20,000 is a fair price. However," he continued, stroking his stubbly, practically non-existent chin, "it's obvious that you've had some sort of bad experience with the Jedi. I am not without compassion. In recognition of your past tragedy, I might be persuaded to lower my price to 18,000, but not a desecred lower."
"And I am not without some remorse for my behavior. As a gesture of apology, I'll raise my offer to 8,000. Take it or leave it."
15,000. I'm cutting my own throat here."
10,000.
12.
Zippa leaned back in midair, folding his spindly arms in a gesture of finality. "Done," Lorne said. He had been ready to go as high as 15, but of course there was no reason for Zippa to know that. He pulled a thick wad of Republic credits from a belt compartment and began counting them. Most transactions up levels were handled by electronic credit chips, but few people use the chips down here. Zippa brought the holocron back into view and handed it to Lorne simultaneously, with Lorne handing him the bills. Lorne accepted the cube. "Well," he said, "it's been a pleasure doing..." He left the sentence unfinished when he saw that Bilk was now pointing a blaster directly at I-5's recharge coupling. Zippa, his smile now decidedly unpleasant, floated forward and plucked the holocron and the remainder of the credits from Lauren's hand.
"I'm afraid in this case the pleasure is all mine," the Toydarian said, as both Lorne and I-5 raised their hands.
Then Zippa's smile vanished, and the next words came out in a sinister hiss.
"No one ever threatens me and lives to tell about it."
One three-fingered hand made a pass before a sensor plate, and the booth door slid open.
"I'll tell the proprietor that Booth 9 will be needing some extra cleaning," he said as he exited. "Hurry up, Bilk. I want to find another buyer for this item."
The booth door closed after Zippa's departure. It was impossible to tell if the pig-like snout of the Gamorrean was smiling, but Lorne was pretty sure it was. "What's the galaxy coming to when you can't trust a Toydarian fence?" he said to I-5.
"Disgraceful," the droid agreed. "It just makes me want to scream."
Lorne still had his hands raised, and now he quickly jammed his two index fingers into his ears as deeply as he could, as a deafening high-pitched screech came from I-5's vocabulator. Even with his ears plugged, the volume was excruciatingly painful. Bilk, caught with no defense, reacted exactly as they had hoped he would. He howled in pain and reflexively clapped both hands over his ears, dropping the blaster in the process. I-5 stopped the scream, caught the weapon before it could hit the floor, and in another second was aiming it at Bilk. The Gamorrean either didn't notice this fact or was too enraged to care. Snarling, he lunged at Lorne and the droid. The particle beam punched through Bilk's armored chest plate, seared its way through various internal organs, and exited between the shoulder blades. The beam's intense heat instantly cauterized the wound, stopping any visible bleeding. Not that that mattered much to Bilk. He dropped to the floor like a sack of meat, which was essentially what he had become. Lorne waved his hand over the exit plate, and the panel snapped open again. "Come on, before Zippa gets away," he shouted to the droid as he charged through the lobby. The proprietor barely glanced up as they dashed by. They both emerged into the dim light of the dead-end street, Lorne now holding the blaster, which I-5 had tossed to him. But there was no sign of Zippa. No doubt he had heard I-5 scream, realized Bilk's probable fate, and let his wings carry him out of sight as fast as possible. Lorne slammed a fist against the graffiti-scarred wall.
"Great," he groaned. "That's just great. 15,000 credits and the cube gone. And I had someone on the hook to pay 50,000 for an authentic holocron."
"Perhaps if you hadn't committed that slight blunder earlier." Lorne turned and glared at I-5, who continued, "But now may not be the most appropriate time to discuss it." Lorne took a deep breath, let it out slowly. Dusk was falling fast.
"Come on," he said. "We'd better get out of this sector before the raptors find us. That would be the perfect end of the day."
"So," I-5 said as they started walking, "was it a real Jedi holocron?"
"I didn't get a chance to examine it closely, but from the cuneiform on it, I'd say it was even rarer than that. I'd think it was a Sith holocron."
Lorne shook his head in disgust, mostly self-disgust. He knew I-5 was right. His burst of temper had probably precipitated Zippa's reneging. He'd dealt with the Toydarian before and never been double-crossed.
Stupid, stupid, stupid.
But there was no point in self-flagellation. He was out of credits, and this was a bad part of Coruscant to be in with no assets. He needed a hustle, and he needed it soon, or he might very likely wind up as dead as Bilk. Not at all a comforting thought. 4. Newt Gunray pushed the plate of fungus aside in irritation. It was his favorite dish. Black mulch mold marinated in the alkaloid secretions of the blight beetle, seasoned to perfection, with the spores just beginning to fruit. Normally his taste and olfactory nodes would be quivering in ecstasy at the prospect of such a gastronomic experience. But he had no appetite. indeed had not been able to look at food since the Sith Lord's last appearance on the bridge, when Sidious had noticed that Hath Monchar was missing. "Take it away," he snapped at the service droid, hovering respectfully nearby. The plate was removed, and Gunray stood, stepping away from the table. He faced one of the trans-peristeel ports, looking gloomily out at the infinite vista of the starfield. There was still no news of Monchar, and no clue as to where he had gone. If the Viceroy had to guess, and guessing was all he had at this point, he would say that his deputy Viceroy had decided to go into business for himself. There were plenty of ways that the knowledge of the impending blockade could be converted into currency, enough currency to begin a new life on a new world. Gunray felt fairly confident that this was Monchar's plan, largely because he had thought of doing it himself more than once. That didn't make it any less of a problem, however. Unless Monchar could be returned to the Sokak before Sidious contacted them again. He heard the panel to his suite chime softly. "Come," he said. The panel slid open, and Rune Hakko entered. The settlement officer of the Trade Federation forces crossed the room, sat down, and arranged his purple raiment with meticulous precision, smoothing the pleats assiduously before looking at Gunray. "I assume there has been no further word of Hath Monchar?" "None." Hakko nodded. He fiddled with his collar for a moment, then adjusted his bloused sleeves. Gunray felt a flash of irritation. He could read Hakko like a data file. He knew the attorney had a suggestion to make regarding the situation, and he knew also that this circuitous approach to it was designed to put Gunray on the defensive. But protocol demanded that he show nothing of what he felt. To do so would be to acknowledge that Hakko had the upper hand in the situation. At last Hakko looked up, meeting Gunray's eyes. "Perhaps I might suggest a course of action." Gunray made a slight hand gesture, designed to convey no more than polite interest. "By all means." "In my offices for the Trade Federation, I have had occasion to encounter a number of people with singular attributes and abilities." He adjusted the crossed points on his cowl. "I refer specifically to a certain human female named Maui Lin. For a prearranged fee, she searches for and retrieves people who have strayed from their duties or who have committed crimes." "You are speaking of a bounty hunter," Gunray said. He saw Hakko restrain himself from smirking and realized belatedly that by admitting knowledge of the term used for someone of such crass abilities, he had lost face before his subordinate. He didn't care, however. He was too excited at the possibility the attorney's suggestion presented. "We could hire this Maui Lin to track down Monchar and bring him back before Sidious convenes with us again." "Just so." Gunray noted the veiled contempt in Hakko's tone. He adjusted his own collar and took his time replying. His initial excitement at a potential solution to the problem had calmed slightly, and now he decided to show Rune Hakko that one did not lightly play games of position with a commanding viceroy of the Federation. "And you know this personage?" he inquired, his tone and expression conveying just the right amount of disdain that anyone of Hakko's station would admit to having had actual social intercourse with such a low individual. Hakko's look of smugness wavered. His fingers plucked nervously at a bit of filigree. "As I said, in the course of my duties as attorney and diplomatic attaché for the Federation..." "Of course." Gunray infused the two words with equal parts pity and haughtiness. "And the Trade Federation is most grateful to you for your willingness to fraternize with such colorful characters, in hopes that their abilities may one day somehow be of use." He watched Hakko's lips purse together as though the barrister had bitten into a rotten truffle, and continued. "To be sure, desperate times call for desperate measures. Though I regret having to ask this of a person of your stature, I hope you can find it within yourself to once again contact this Maui Lin in order that we may satisfactorily resolve the Monchar situation." Rune Hakko muttered in acquiescence and left. After the door closed, Newt Gunray nodded in satisfaction. Not bad. Not bad at all. He had managed to implement a possible solution to the question of Monchar's disappearance, and at the same time had taken that insufferable prig Hacko down a peg. He listened in pleasure to a faint rumbling in his gut sack that signified the return of his appetite. Perhaps he would give his dinner another try. "Had the hut primed for this," Lauren said. "Was ready to part with a great deal of cash for a real Jedi holocron. Would have paid twice as much for one from the Sith." He gazed dejectedly into the depths of his glass, swirling the remaining blue-green Jorian whiskey that had recently filled it. 50,000 credits, the cube was worth. Now I've lost it, and the 15,000, all I had. "It does put us in somewhat desperate straits financially," I-5 said. The two were sitting at the bar near the back of the green glowstone tavern, not far from one end of the infamous Crimson Corridor section of the city. They were regular patrons, and the droid's presence there no longer caused much controversy, despite the sign at the entrance that proclaimed "No droids allowed" in Basic and several other languages. "It's all my fault," Lauren muttered, more to the drink-stained counter than to I-5. "Had lost my temper." He fixed the droid with a somewhat bleary gaze. "Dunno why you stay partners with me." "Ah, now we come to the maudlin stage. Will this take long? I may want to put myself in cyberestasis until it's over." Lauren grunted and signaled for another refill. "You can be a real bastard, you know that?" he told I-5. "Let's see. According to my databanks, the primary definition of bastard is a child born of unwed parents. However, a secondary usage is something of irregular or unusual origins. In that respect, I suppose I qualify." When the bartender came over to fill Lauren's glass again, I-5 put his hand over it. "My friend has had enough neurons destroyed by various hydroxyl compounds for today. It's not like he has an overabundant supply in the first place." The bartender, a Bothan, glanced at Lorne, then shrugged and moved on down the bar. A Duros, wearing spacer's togs and sitting nearby, looked at them, seeming to register the droid's presence for the first time. "You let your droid decide how much you can drink?" he asked Lorne. "'S not my droid," Lorne said. "We're partners. Business associates." He pronounced the words carefully. The Duros flickered nictitating membranes over his eyes in a sign of surprise and disbelief. "You're telling me that droid has citizenship status?" "He's not telling you anything," I-5 said as he turned to face the Duros. "Largely because he's so drunk he can barely stand. I'm telling you to mind your own business. My status in galactic society is not your concern." The Duros glanced around, saw that the rest of the tavern's patrons were rather pointedly ignoring the exchange, shrugged, and went back to his drink. I-5 pulled Lorne off the bar stool and aimed him in the direction of the door. Lorne walked, weaving across the room, then turned and faced the tavern. "I was somebody once," he told the group, most of whom didn't bother to look up. "Worked up levels, penthouse suite. Could see the mountains. Damn Jedi. They did this to me." Then he turned and walked out, I-5 following. Outside, the air was chill, and Lorne could feel a small amount of sobriety returning. The sun had set, and the long twilight of the equatorial regions had begun. "Guess I told them, didn't I?" "Absolutely. They were riveted. I'm sure they can't wait for the next thrilling installment. In the meantime, why don't we go home before one of the colorful locals decides to see how fast alcohol-soaked human tissue burns?" "Good idea," Lorne agreed as I-5 took his arm and started walking. They passed sidewalk vendors offering bootleg hollows, glitter stem, and other illegal items for sale. Beggars of various species, wrapped in tattered cloaks, pawed at them for alms. They entered the nearest kiosk entrance to the underground, descending a long broken escalator that ended in a winding corridor. It had been warm on the surface. Down here, it was like a sauna. The mingled body odor of various unwashed beings moving through the passageway, combined with the fungal reek permeating the walls, verged on hallucinogenic. Why can't they all smell like Toydarians? Lorne wondered. They turned down a narrow side passage, its walls and ceiling a complex pattern of pipes, conduits, and cables. Flickering luminescent strips at irregular intervals provided dim illumination. Granite slugs oozed along the floor, requiring Lorne to pay attention to where he stepped. No small task in his condition. Eventually they reached the third in a series of recessed metal doors, which he opened after several tries with his key card. The windowless cubicle, a cell carved from the city's massive ferricrete foundation, was designed for single occupancy, but since Lorne's roommate was a droid, they were not particularly cramped for space. There were a couple of chairs, an extensible wall cot, a tiny refresher, and a kitchenette barely big enough for a nanowave and food preserver. The compartment was spotlessly clean, another advantage of having a droid around. Lorne sat on the edge of the cot and stared at the floor. "Here's all you need to know about the Jedi," he announced. "Oh, please, not again. They're a bunch of self-serving, sanctimonious elitists. I have this entire rant recorded, you know. I could play a holo at fast speed. It would save time. Guardians of the Galaxy, don't make me laugh. All they're interested in guarding is their way of life. If I were you, a hypothetical situation, the mere mention of which threatens to overload my logic circuits, I'd stop obsessing over the Jedi and start thinking about where my next meal is coming from. I don't require nourishment, but you do. You need something hot to pedal, fast." Lorne glared at the droid. "I never should have disconnected your creativity damper." He brooded for a while longer, then said, "But you're right. No point dwelling in the past. Got to look ahead. What we need is a plan, right now." And with those words, he fell backwards onto the cot and began to snore loudly. I-5 stared at his recumbent companion. "Random evolution should never have been entrusted with intelligence," the droid muttered. 3. Darsha Asant stood before the Jedi Council. This was a moment of glory that she had dreamed about ever since she had begun her Padawan training. For nearly her entire life, the world within the Jedi Temple had been, to all extents and purposes, her only world. During those years, she had studied, had practiced weapon and bare hand forms, had sat in meditation for hours on end, and, in many ways the most difficult task of all, had learned to sense and manipulate, to a small degree, the power of the Force. And now she was close to the culmination of her training. Now she stood in the topmost chamber of the spire known as the Jedi Council, with its spectacular view of the planetary city spreading away in all directions to the far horizon. Seated in 12 chairs around the perimeter of the rotunda were the members of the council. Though she had seen them but rarely during her years of training, indeed this was only the 4th time she had been in the council chamber, she knew their names and histories well from her studies. Adi Gallia, Plo Koon, Eeth Koth, the ancient and venerable Yoda, and, of course, Mace Windu, a senior member of the council. Darsha felt more than a little giddy just being in the presence of this august company. At least she was not standing there alone. Behind her and slightly to one side was her mentor, Anun Bandara. Master Bandara epitomized what Darsha hoped to become one day. The Twi'lek Jedi Master lived in the Force. Always still and complacent as a pool of unknown depth, he was nevertheless one of the best fighters in the Order. His skill with a lightsaber was second to none. Darsha hoped that one day she might be able to exhibit a tenth of Anun Bandara's adeptness. Darsha had entered the Order at the age of 2, so like most of her comrades, she had no real memories of any place other than the cloistered hallways and chambers of the temple. Master Bandara had been parent and teacher to her for as long as she could remember. She found it hard to conceive of a life in which her Jedi mentor was not involved. Yet now she was taking a big step into just that sort of life. For today, she would be given the final assignment of her Padawan training. If she completed it successfully, she would be deemed worthy to assume the mantle of a Jedi Knight. It was still so hard to believe. She had been orphaned in infancy on the planet Alderaan and was being raised as a state foundling when Master Bondura happened across her in his travels. Even as an infant, she had shown strong force tendencies, so she was told, and she had been brought to Coruscant in hopes of qualifying for training. Darsha knew she had been phenomenally lucky. As an orphan raised by the state, her best hope would have been some obscure mid-level government job. She would have been just another one of the countless departmental drones necessary to the smooth functioning of a planetary government, had she not been discovered by someone who recognized her potential. But now, to stand on the verge of becoming a Jedi, to be one of the ancient order of protectors, one of the guardians of freedom and justice in the galaxy, even now, after all these years of preparation, she could hardly believe it was true. Padawan Asant. Master Windu was speaking to her. The dark-eyed human's mellifluous voice was quietly pitched, yet its power seemed to fill the large room. Darsha took a deep breath, reaching for the force to calm and steady her. Now was definitely not the time to appear nervous. The Jedi Master wasted no time in pleasantries. You are to go alone to the area in the Zykri sector known as the Crimson Corridor, where a former member of Black Sun is being kept in a safe house. He is to receive the Council's protection in return for information regarding a recent shake-up in the higher echelons of that criminal organization. Your job is to bring him back to the temple alive. Darsha was afire with eagerness, but she knew it would be unseemly to show it. She bowed slightly. I understand, Master Windu. I shall not fail. Evidently, she was not entirely successful in maintaining her equanimity, because she saw a slight smile tug at the senior member's lips. Well, so be it. Being too enthusiastic was certainly not a crime. Mace Windu raised his hand in a gesture of dismissal. Darsha turned and exited the rotunda, followed by Anun Bandura. As the doors slid noiselessly shut behind her, Darsha faced her mentor. The question on her lips as to how soon she would begin her mission remained unasked, however, when she saw the look of worry in Master Bondura's eyes. Master, what is it? For a moment she was certain that there was disappointment in the Twi'lek's gaze as well, that Darsha had said or done something before the council to dishonor herself and her mentor. The fear sliced through her like a lightsaber's deadly edge, but the Jedi's first words relieved her of that concern. It is a most arduous mission, Master Bondura said. I am surprised at Master Windu's choice of this particular test. Do you doubt my ability to accomplish it? The thought that her mentor might lack faith in her was even more distressing than the possibility of having unknowingly embarrassed herself before the council. Master Bondura hesitated, then looked her squarely in the eyes and smiled. I have always taught you to be honest in your feelings, the Jedi said, for they are the surest conduit to knowledge, both of the self and of the force. Therefore, I cannot be less than honest with you. As part of your trials, you must go alone, and I am concerned that the mission may be too difficult and dangerous a test. The Crimson Corridor is rife with gangs, criminals, street predators, and other dangers. Also, several assassination attempts have already been made on the Black Sun member's life. But the Twi'lek's Leku twitched in a way that Darsha had come to recognize as a fatalistic shrug. The Council's decision is final, and we must accept it. Be assured that my concern in no way reflects my opinion of your abilities. Assign it rather to the frets and misgivings of advancing age. I am sure you will acquit yourself well. Now come, we must prepare for your departure. Darsha followed her mentor as the latter moved down the corridor toward the turbolift. Master Bondura's words had dampened her enthusiasm slightly. What if he was right? What if this was too dangerous an assignment? She had heard stories of the dangers in the infamous Crimson Corridor, and she would be on her own for the first time, without Master Bondura or even another Padawan as backup. Could she do it? She squared her shoulders. Of course she could. She was a Jedi, or would be as soon as she completed this assignment. Mace Windu must have thought her capable of it. He would not have assigned it otherwise. She had to trust in the living force, as Master Qui-Gon Jinn, another of her tutors, had often said. She was not going into danger alone. She had the force with her. It would not make her invulnerable, but it certainly gave her an advantage few others had. With the force, she could accomplish things most people viewed as nigh unto miraculous. She could leap twice her own height in a one-gravity field. She could slow her rate of descent in a fall. She could even telekinetically move items a dozen meters and more away. And she could also cloak herself in its essence, hiding in plain sight, so to speak. Granted, her ability to do these things weren't on the same level of expertise as her mentors. Nevertheless, she was better off with the force than without it. That was for sure. She would not fail. She would accomplish her mission, and when she returned to the temple, the title of Jedi Knight would be waiting for her. The infiltrator emerged from hyperspace well inside the Coruscant system and continued sublight toward the capital world. Darth Maul kept the ship cloaked, though he would drop that as he neared his destination. Extended cloaking took too much power. His coordinates and entry code had been given to him by his lord and master, and would clear him through the orbital security grid to land at any spaceport on the planet. Still, the less noticeable he was, the better. Even a single raised eyebrow at the sight of the infiltrator resting on a landing pad was too much. The ship had been provided for him by Lord Sidious only recently, and he was still getting used to it. It handled well and easily, however. He approached Coruscant over the South Pole. He was not concerned about being spotted, even though Coruscant had the most sophisticated and far-reaching system of detection arrays of any world in the galaxy. The infiltrator boasted a state-of-the-art stygium crystal cloaking device and thrust trace dampers capable of confounding even Coruscant's warning grids. He chose as his landing site a rooftop pad on an abandoned monad in an area of the city awaiting urban demolition and renewal. He left the cloaking device activated and deployed his speeder bike through the cargo hatch. The bike was a stripped-down model designed for maximum speed and maneuverability. Maul continued his journey across the cityscape on it. Lord Sidious had been able to learn that Hath Monshar maintained an apartment on Coruscant in a well-to-do section of the city several kilometers south of the Minari Mountains. Maul did not know the exact address, but that did not matter. He would find the missing Nemordian, even if he had to search the entire planetary city. It was impossible even to conceive of a time when he had not been in thrall to Darth Sidious. He knew that he had come originally from a world called Iridonia. But knowing that was like knowing that the atoms composing his body had originally been born in the primordial galactic furnaces that had forged the stars. The knowledge was interesting in a remote academic way, but no more than that. He had no interest whatsoever in learning any more about his past or his homeworld. As far as he was concerned, his life began with Lord Sidious. And if his master ordered an end to that life, Maul would accept that judgment with no argument. But that would not happen as long as he served Lord Sidious to the best of his abilities, which of course he would. He could not even imagine a situation or circumstance that would prevent him from doing so. Faintly, from behind him, came the wail of a siren. Maul glanced back over his shoulder and saw he was being pursued by a police droid on a speeder similar to his own. The sight did not surprise him. He knew he was breaking several traffic laws due to his speed and course. Just as he knew there was no way the droid was going to catch him. Maul pushed the speeder bike to maximum velocity, rocketing through the ferrocrete labyrinth on a plane between two levels of skycar traffic. The speeder had no stealth capabilities, but that did not matter. His speed and his control were more than sufficient to leave the pursuing droid behind. He knew the droid was comlinking ahead, calling for reinforcements to surround him and bring him to a stop. He couldn't let that happen. There was a break in the lower traffic flow ahead. Maul altered the speeder's thrust angle and dived through it, descending several stories until he dropped through a fog layer that hovered perhaps 30 meters above the ground. They could still track him, of course, but he knew that as long as he was not endangering any lives other than his own, he would not be as high a priority to them. Besides, he had almost reached his destination. He arrived without further incident and parked the speeder bike in one of the local lots, paying for the rest of the day in advance. Then he stepped onto a sidewalk that carried him toward one of the many outposts of the Coruscant Customs Bureau. Several times he noticed people looking at him. His appearance was capable of turning heads, even on so cosmopolitan a planet as Coruscant. It would take considerable concentration to blind these crowds to his presence by using the Force, though it could be done. But it did not matter who saw him at this point. If all went according to plan, he would be off Coruscant in less than a day, his mission completed. He had one thing to his advantage. Even though there was a bigger variety of alien races and species here than practically anywhere else in the galaxy, there still weren't a lot of Nemoidians to be seen, due to the recent tension between the Republic and the Trade Federation. Maul entered the imposing structure of the Customs Bureau and moved quickly to a databank terminal. Using a password provided by Lord Sidious, he instituted a holonet search that turned up a record of a recently arrived Nemoidian. The image matched the one of Hath Monchar given to him by his master. The name was different, but that was not surprising. Maul ordered a new search parameter, trying to track Monchar through debit card use. There was no record of any transactions. Again, not surprising. The Nemoidian would be too canny to be caught that way. No doubt he used only cash while on Coruscant. A line had begun to form behind him. Other people wanted to use the terminal he was monopolizing. He could hear grumbling voices as citizens and tourists grew increasingly impatient. He ignored them. He hacked into the planet-wide security grid that monitored the spaceports and surrounding environs, calling up the last 24 hours of a constant collage of images taken by stationary and roving holocams. He ordered the system to search its files for Nemoidians. He found several images, one of which was promising. It wasn't much to go on, a blurred image of a Nemoidian entering a tavern not far from there a few hours earlier, but it was better than nothing. Maul smiled faintly. His hand brushed the grip of the double-bladed lightsaber that hung from his belt. He noted the address of the tavern, then turned and left the building. 5. Darth Sidious was also thinking about the Jedi. Their fire was dying in the galaxy. Of that there was no doubt. For more than 1,000 generations, they had been the self-appointed paladins of the Commonweal, but that was now coming to an end, and the pathetic fools, blinded by their own hypocrisy, could not see the truth of this. It was right and fitting that this be so, just as it was right and fitting that the instrument of their downfall be the Sith. The few pedants and scholars who even knew the name thought that the Sith were the dark side of the Jedi Knights. This was, of course, far too simplistic an evaluation. It was true that they had embraced the teachings of a group of rogue Jedi thousands of years ago, but they had taken that knowledge and philosophy far beyond the insular didacticism they had been given to start with. It was easy and convenient as well to demarcate the concept of the Force into light and dark. Indeed, even Sidious had used such notions of duality in the training of his disciple. But the reality was that there was only the Force. It was above such petty concepts as positive and negative, black and white, good and evil. The only difference worthy of note was this. The Jedi saw the Force as an end in itself. The Sith knew that it was a means to an end. And that end was power. For all their humble posturing and protestations of abdication, the Jedi craved power as much as anyone. Sidious knew this to be true. They claimed to be the servants of the people, but over the centuries they had increasingly removed themselves from contact with the very citizens they ostensibly served. Now they prowled the cloistered hallways and chambers of their temple, mouthing their empty ideologies, while practicing hubristic machinations designed to bring them more secular power. As one half of the entire existing order of the Sith, Darth Sidious craved power as well. It was true that he was operating covertly toward that end, but he was doing so out of necessity, not sophistry. After the Great Sith War, the Order had been decimated. The lone remaining Sith had revived the Order according to a new doctrine. One master and one apprentice. Thus it had been, and thus it would be, until that glorious day that saw the fall of the Jedi and the ascendancy of their ancient enemies, the Sith. And that day was fast approaching. After centuries of planning and collusion, it was now almost here. Sidious was confident that he would see its culmination in his lifetime. There would come a day in the not-too-distant future when he would stand, triumphant, over the last Jedi's body, when he would see their temple raised, when he would take his rightful place as ruler of the galaxy. Which was why no loose ends, no matter how inconsequential, could be permitted. Perhaps Hath Monchar's absence had nothing to do with the Trade Federation's looming blockade of the planet Naboo. That was conceivable, but as long as the slightest chance existed that it did, the Nemoidian had to be found and dealt with. Darth Sidious looked at the wall chrono. It was now slightly over 14 standard hours since he had given Maul the assignment. He anticipated hearing from his apprentice shortly. The stakes were high, very high, but he had every confidence that Maul would perform the task with his customary ruthless efficiency. All would continue as planned, and the Sith would rise again. Soon. Very soon. The Crimson Quarter was in the third quadrant of the Zykri sector. It was one of the oldest areas of the vast planetary metropolis, overbuilt with skyscrapers and towers constructed long ago. The buildings towered so tall and so thick that some areas of the corridor received only a few minutes of sunlight a day. Darsha remembered hearing legends of inbred subhuman tribes living in the near-total darkness of its depths for so long that they had gone genetically blind. But darkness was the least of the dangers in the corridor. Far worse were the things, both human and non-human, that lived in the darkness and preyed on the unwary. Darsha piloted her skyhopper down through the miasmal fog that lay like a filthy blanket over the lowest levels. Why, she wondered, would anyone pick a neighborhood like this for a place in which to conceal informants? The answer was, of course, that it was the last place anyone would look. The safe house, a barricaded block of ferrocrete and plasteel, was in a street that was not wide enough for her to set the skyhopper down. She landed in the closest intersection, got out, and instructed the autopilot to take the craft up 20 meters and remain in hover mode there. That way it was more likely to be there when she got back. There were a few glow sticks and protective wired cages set here and there on the buildings, but after centuries of use they were so weak that they did little to relieve the gloom. As soon as Darsha disembarked from her vehicle, she was set upon by beggars supplicating for food and money. At first she tried the ancient Jedi technique of clouding their minds, but there were too many of them, and most of them had brains too addled by privation and various illegal chemicals to respond to the suggestion. She gritted her teeth and pushed her way through the forest of filthy waving arms, tentacles, and various other appendages. The mingled revulsion and sympathy she felt was almost overwhelming. For nearly as long as she could remember, Darsha had been coddled and cozened in the Jedi Temple. Protected from direct contact with the dregs of society, an ironic situation, since the Jedi were supposed to be the protectors of all levels of civilization, even those considered untouchable by most of the upper classes. True, elements of her training had taken her to various rough neighborhoods, but nowhere else had she seen anything that even remotely compared with this. It horrified her that such poverty and neglect could exist anywhere, let alone on Coruscant. She made it to the recessed entrance of the safe house and pounded on the reinforced door. A slit opened, and a sentry cam extruded from it. "Your name and business?" it asked in a rasping voice. "Darsha Asant, on the Jedi Council's business." An emaciated Kubaz sought to pluck her lightsaber from its hook on her utility belt. She seized his hand and bent the thumb backwards. He squealed and backed hastily away, but others took his place immediately. The only reason they did not drag her back into the street was that there were too many to crowd into the narrow aperture where she stood. The security cam quickly ran a laser scan over her face.
Identity confirmed. Please hold your breath.
Darsha did so, whereupon hidden nozzles surrounding the door sprayed a pink mist at the crowd of mendicants. A chorus of indignant shouts, squeals, bleats, and other protests rose from them as the airborne irritant drove them momentarily back. The door slid quickly up, and a metallic arm grabbed Darsha and pulled her inside. She found herself in a narrow corridor that was almost as dark as the street. The security droid who had taken her arm now led her down this passageway and around a corner into a small, windowless room. The light was not much better here. Darsha could barely make out a hunched form sitting on a chair. Bald and humanoid, he looked like a Fondorian to her. The droid said,
"This is the Jedi who will take you to safety, Ulth."
Though she knew it was foolish, Darsha felt a little thrill at being called a Jedi, even by a droid.
"About time," the Fondorian said. He stood quickly. "Let's get out of here before it gets dark. Not that it ever really stops getting dark around here."
He moved toward the room's entrance, then stopped and looked back at Darsha.
"Well, come on," he said testily. "What are you waiting for?"
"I'm just trying to decide how best to get back to my skyhopper," Darsha replied. "I don't relish the idea of wading through those poor beings out there again."
"We'll be the poor beings if we don't get moving. This is Raptor territory. They make those scum out there look like the Republic Senate. Now let's go."
Darsha moved toward the hallway. Ulth stood aside to let her pass.
"I'm the one who needs protecting. You go first."
Whatever good he was to the Council, Darsha was sure Ulth the Fondorian wasn't valued for his bravery. She pushed past him and strode back to the outside door. The cam's monitor was mounted by the door. It showed a few street people still loitering around the area. Most of them, however, had apparently gone looking for someone else to importune. If Darsha and Ulth moved quickly, they could probably get back to the intersection where her vehicle was without too much trouble.
"All right," Darsha said. She took a deep breath and reached for the Force to calm herself. She was a Jedi Padawan with a job to do. Time to get on with it. "Let's move out."
The door panel slid open. Darsha quested with the Force and felt no sense of anybody nearby who posed a danger. Thus reassured, she started down the street with Ulth. The vagrants seemed to materialize from out of the shadows, clustering around them again. Ulth shoved at them as they crowded in.
"Get away from me, filthy creatures!"
"Just keep moving," Darsha said to him. She had refused the droid's offer of escort because she didn't want to draw any more attention than absolutely necessary. If she had to, she could activate her lightsaber. She had no doubt that just the sight of the energy blade would send the majority of the street people fleeing. But she hoped it wouldn't be necessary. They were almost to the intersection. And then her heart, already pounding from nervous tension, suddenly tried to batter its way up her throat. Her skyhopper was still where she had parked it, hovering 20 meters up in the air. Clustered on the street beneath it was a heterogeneous assortment of beings, about a dozen in all. Among the species Darsha recognized were humans, Kubas, Henemthi, Gotals, Snivians, Trandoshans, and Bith. All of them appeared to be in the late adolescent stage of their particular species. All were dressed in colorful and motley styles, and all looked extremely dangerous. Ulth the Fondorian gasped and whispered in a strangled tone,
"The Raptors!"
Darsha had heard tales of the street gangs that terrorized many of the more run-down sectors of Coruscant surface. The Raptors were reputed to be the worst by far. She had hoped to complete her mission quickly enough to avoid an encounter with them. So much for that idea. Several grappling hooks had snagged into the two-person craft, and from them dangled ropes. Three members of the gang, a human female and two male Bith, had climbed aboard and were busily ransacking the vehicle. They tossed on various items, a holoprojector, an aquata breather, a pouch of food capsules, and medical supplies, to the gang members below. Even as Darsha watched, one of them managed to disable the autopilot, causing the craft to settle gently to the street. This was greeted by a cheer from the rest of the gang. Ulth grabbed her robe and tried to pull her into the shadows of the narrow street.
"Quick, before they see us."
She shook off his grasp.
"I can't let them strip the skyhopper. It's our only way out of here.
wait here until I've dealt with them. Then, forcing herself to project a confidence she did not in any way feel, Darsha strode toward the raptors. She hadn't taken more than a few steps before her approach was noted. The raucous chatter and laughter quickly subsided. No doubt, Darsha thought, because they were having a hard time believing someone could be this suicidal. She stopped a few meters from them. There was no one else on the street now, save for the Fondorian cowering somewhere behind her. No one in their right mind wanted to be around when the raptors were on the prowl. "That's my skyhopper," she said, relieved to find that her voice was not shaking. "Please return the things you stole and move away from it." The raptors looked at each other in astonishment before breaking into the various sounds that constituted laughter for each species. One of the human males, lean and wiry, sporting an improbable mane of green hair standing straight up in an electrostatic field, swaggered toward her. "New around here, I'm guessing," he said, causing more sniggering, this time with a distinctly unpleasant edge, to erupt from his compatriots. Darsha reviewed her options quickly. There weren't many. She was one against a dozen, and while her knowledge of the Jedi fighting arts improved the odds somewhat, she was still not at all confident in her ability to come out ahead in a battle. She was on their turf, after all, and for all she knew, there might be a dozen more of them lurking in the shadows. But there were alternatives to fighting. The mind trick she had tried earlier on the beggars hadn't been completely successful, but it had turned away a few of them. It might serve now to confuse the raptors long enough to allow her to reach the vehicle. Of course, she still had to get Ulth in the craft with her, but one problem at a time. She raised her right hand, fanning the fingers in a gesture designed to focus their attention while she reached out mentally for the Force. "You're not interested in me," she said, using the soft but compelling tone she had been taught. "Or my vehicle." She could see by their confused and uncertain expressions that it was working, could feel their wills beginning to vibrate in resonance with hers. Green Hair was either the leader or something close to it, because when he nodded and said slowly, "We're not interested in her, or her vehicle," the rest of the gang mumbled the same words in ragged unison. Darsha took a few steps forward, making the hypnotic gesture again. "You might as well go now," she told Green Hair. "There's nothing interesting going on here." "We might as well go now. There's nothing interesting going on here." The rest of the gang again echoed him. Darsha kept moving slowly but steadily forward. She stepped past Green Hair and was now in the midst of them, only a step or two away from her craft. She had them now. She could feel their minds, some struggling feebly, others willingly surrendering to her suggestive power amplified by the Force. Another moment and she would be in the skyhopper. A scream echoed down the dark street. Startled, Darsha whipped around, staring back toward the source of the cry. It was Ulth the Fondorian, staggering out into the middle of the narrow thoroughfare, shaking and kicking his leg frantically to dislodge a large armored rat that had clamped its jaws onto his shin. Even as she realized who it was, she realized as well that her tenuous mind lock on the raptors had been shattered by the unexpected sound. Blinking and shaking their heads as if awakening from slumber, the raptors realized that their prey had obligingly delivered itself right into their midst. Darsha had no choice now but to fight. She reached for her lightsaber, but before she could seize it, they were upon her. 6. Hath Monchar was afraid. This was not a particularly surprising state of affairs to anyone who knew the Deputy Viceroy of the Trade Federation. Even among Nemoidians, Monchar was considered remarkably timid, which made it all the more amazing that he had done what he had done. Monchar was afraid, yes, but underneath that was another emotion, one far less familiar to him than fear. This emotion was pride. A nervous and fragile pride, it was true, but pride nevertheless. He had taken a chance, a big chance. He had dared to steer his life in a new and, with any luck, more profitable direction. He had a right to feel proud of that, he told himself. He glanced around at the patrons of the tavern he was sitting in. It was a different establishment than the one he usually frequented when on Coruscant. That tavern was in the affluent Kaldani Spires monad, where he had an apartment. He was not staying in his apartment on this visit, however. That would make him too easy to find. Instead, he had rented a cheap domicile near the Galactic Museum under an assumed name. He had seriously considered buying a holographic image disguiser that could change his appearance to that of another species as well. His paranoia had warred with his parsimony for quite some time on that one. And finally, the stinginess had won out, though just barely. Hathman Char had come to Coruscant because the capital world was the best place to move information quickly and anonymously. That was what he had to sell, information. Specifically, information about the upcoming blockade of Naboo and the fact that the man behind it all was a Sith Lord. It was a dangerous scheme, to be sure. If his co-conspirators found him, Monchar knew they would quickly give him up to Darth Sidious's tender mercies. The mere thought of being in the Sith Lord's clutches was enough to make the Nemoidian start to hyperventilate. Even so, Monchar couldn't resist the opportunity to make a quick fortune. He took another gulp of the agaric ale he was drinking. Yes, the risks were high, but so was the potential for profit. All he needed was to contact the right person as an intermediary, someone who knew the people who would pay handsomely for the news he had. All it would take was a bit more fortitude on his part. He had come this far. He was not going to stop now, not with his goal nearly in sight. Hathman Char signaled the Baragwin bartender. One more flagon of ale ought to give him the fortitude he needed. Maui Lin had been a bounty hunter for going on 10 standard years. Ever since, she had been forced to leave her home world after killing a corrupt government official. During that time, she had traveled nearly the length and breadth of the galaxy on various assignments. She had pursued fugitives from justice on such diverse worlds as Ord Mantell, Rune, Tatooine, and dozens of others. Oddly enough, however, she had never been to Coruscant, and she was looking forward to seeing the capital of the galaxy. The assignment from the Nemoidian Viceroy's lieutenant seemed straightforward enough. Lin did not anticipate any great trouble in finding the missing Hathman Char, even on a crowded world like Coruscant. As her ship descended on autopilot toward the landing pad at the eastern spaceport, she reviewed her equipment and weaponry. Her garb looked like no more than a simple utilitarian tunic and pants, but they were made of densely woven shell spider silk, a material capable of resisting even a vibroblade's thrust, as well as reflecting low-power particle beams and lasers. It was armor that did not look like armor to the uninitiated. Experts would spot it, of course, but she didn't expect to run into any opposition. She wore twin DL-44 blasters on each hip and a small disruptor pistol in a concealed ankle holster. Strapped to each wrist was an MM-9 wrist rocket, and in her right hand she wore a palm flechette shooter. On her utility belt she carried, among other things, a set of stun cuffs, a stun baton, and 3 glop grenades. Maui Lin believed in being prepared. Her first stop after disembarking from her ship was the Kaldani Spire's residential apartments. She seriously doubted that Monchar would be foolish enough to stay in an apartment registered to him, but one never knew. More than once, Lin had saved herself needless trouble and time by looking in the most obvious places for her quarry. As she entered the lobby, the security droid on duty asked whom she wished to see. "Hathman Char," Lin told him. The droid checked a monitor screen, then informed her that Monchar was not in. Indeed, was not even on Coruscant. Lin nodded pleasantly and clapped the circuit disruptors she had pulled from her belt onto the droid's chassis. The droid stuttered for an instant before its photoreceptors went dark. Lin took the lift tube up to the 500th floor and strolled down the corridor to Monchar's apartment, where she used an electronic lock breaker to void the security system. Once inside, she quickly checked the rooms. The droid had been telling the truth. Monchar was not there. Furthermore, the apartment appeared to have been vacant for some time. The large suite was decorated in what was, to a Nemoidian, the epitome of tasteful decor. To Lin, it looked and smelled like a fetid swamp. She did some more investigating, hoping to find a clue to Monchar's whereabouts. In this, she was disappointed. At last she left, going back down to the lobby and pulling the circuit disruptor off the security droid. Before it could reaccess its memory bank sufficiently to realize what had happened, Maui Lin had left and was strolling along one of the skywalks 50 stories above the surface. It would certainly take some time to search a city the size of a planet for one person. Fortunately, Lin felt fairly sure that such a search wouldn't be necessary. Even though Mon Char was smart enough not to stay in his apartment, she was willing to bet that the Nemoidian was somewhere in the general vicinity. This was the part of Coruscant with which he was most familiar, so it made sense that he would be holed up not too far away. Lin stopped at an observation deck and enjoyed the view for a few minutes. The descriptions she had read and the hollows she had seen did not do justice to the stupendousness of the real thing. The last census put the population of Coruscant at somewhere in the neighborhood of a trillion living beings. Even if she could investigate one person every second, she would still need the lifespan of 100 Tatooine Sarlaccs to get to them all. But there were ways to narrow the search. Paranoid as Mon Char no doubt was, he still had to eat. Lin pulled a portable holonet link from a pocket and consulted it, entering search parameters for restaurants in the area that specialized in the disgusting swill Nemoidians called food. As she had thought, there were not all that many. She glanced at her chrono and saw that it was almost the hour when most species eat their evening meal. She would go check out a few of these restaurants. It was worth putting up with the smell if it meant an early resolution to this case. Darth Maul signaled for an air taxi. Even though his speeder was not far away, he did not wish to risk anyone connecting him to it now that he was close to his quarry. The taxi pilot, a Quarren, looked somewhat dubiously at his passenger as Maul got into the back seat, but said nothing as he was given the address. The taxi rose rapidly straight up through two strata of traffic, its lift repulsors humming barely within the threshold of Maul's hearing, then veered north in a long arc toward a cluster of towers in the distance. The taxi landed gently at a terminal within 50 meters of the tavern. Maul entered, stepping immediately to the shadows near the door while he looked about. His vision adjusted far more quickly to extremes of light and darkness than did most species. He was almost able at once to see the tavern's dim interior and its customers. He saw humans, Bith, Deveronians, Nikto, Snivians, Arcona, a cornucopia of species, all drinking or otherwise imbibing various substances capable of altering their brain chemistry. He did not see Hath Mon Char. For that matter, he did not see any Nemoidians at all. Maul approached the bar. The bartender was a tall, gaunt Baraguin, his folds of facial dewlaps as leathery increased as a bantha's skin. "I am looking for a Nemoidian," Maul said to him. "He would have been in here within the last few hours." The Baraguin sent a ripple running through his dewlaps from top to bottom, the equivalent of a human shaking his head. "Many beings come in here," he said, his voice absurdly high and flute-like coming from such a massive head. "They come, they drink, they talk, they go. I do not recall seeing a Nemoidian recently." Darth Maul leaned forward. "Think again," he said softly. He could easily use the Force to get whatever information might be had from this weak-willed creature, but there was no need. He knew he could get what he wanted by intimidation. The Baraguin's nasal polyps began to quiver, a sign of nervousness. "Upon further reflection, I do seem to remember a representative of that species imbibing here perhaps an hour ago." "Did he speak to you or anyone else?" The Baraguin's polyps were vibrating almost too fast to see now. "No. That is, he ordered agaric ale." "And did he speak of anything else?" "Yes, he inquired of me how one might contact someone proficient in the buying and selling of sensitive information." Maul leaned back. "And you told him what?" "I gave him a name."
"You will now give me that name."
The Baraguin rippled his dewlaps from bottom to top in acquiescence. "Lorn Pavan, a human, Corellian, I believe. He is well known in this city sector as one who traffics in such merchandise."
And where might I find this Lorne Pavan?
I do not know.
Maul leaned forward again, his yellow eyes blazing. The Baragwin backed up hastily.
I speak the truth. He comes in here occasionally, always accompanied by a protocol droid called I-5. I know nothing more.
That was interesting news, Maul reflected. It should help to narrow the search. Personal droids were not that common in this area of Coruscant.
Describe this Lorne Pavan.
Tall, muscular, black filamentous cilia on his scalp, but none on his face. Brown ocular pigmentation. The females of his species would probably characterize him as handsome.
Maul nodded, then raised his right hand in a focusing gesture as he mentally reached for the Force. He had to make sure that this next question was answered truthfully, because the answer would determine whether or not he had to kill the Baragwin.
Did the Nemoidian speak at all to you about the nature of the information he wished to sell?
The dewlaps quickly undulated downward.
He did not. I have told you all that I know.
Maul sensed no negative vibration in the Force as the Baragwin spoke. He turned away without another word and exited the tavern.
He was glad that he did not have to kill the Baragwin, not out of any moral sense or even out of pity for the pathetic creature. His relief stemmed purely from having avoided the inevitable difficulties brought on by killing someone in a public place. Nevertheless, if the Force had told him the Baragwin was lying, he would have struck him down without a second thought and dealt with the consequences.
Darth Sidious had told him to kill everyone with whom Hath Monchar had shared knowledge of the blockade, and Maul would follow his master's commands, as always. He strode along the outdoor concourse, pondering his next move. Though the walkway was crowded, his passage was not impeded, as most of the pedestrians gave him a wide berth. Which was as it should be. Darth Maul had nothing but contempt for the masses. Of all the uncounted trillions of sentient beings that populated the galaxy, only one was deserving of respect. Darth Sidious. The only man who dared to dream of conquering not just a world or a star system, but an entire galaxy. The man who had taken the young Maul from a backwater planet and raised him to be his successor. He owed Darth Sidious everything. It had not been an easy path that he had been set upon. To be a truly superior being, apart from and above the senseless herd, required absolute devotion and dedication. He had had to learn self-sufficiency, both in body and in mind, almost from the time he had learned to walk. His master would accept nothing less than the absolute best that Maul could offer. When he was younger, if he had flinched during his training when the edge of a weapon found his flesh, or when an incorrect block or defensive maneuver resulted in a cracked bone, his punishments had always been swift and inevitable. He had soon learned to think of pain as his teacher. From fearing it, he had actually come to welcome it because he knew it would test his willpower and his courage. It would make him stronger. To be content, to be comfortable, was to be complacent. No one learned anything from pleasure. Pain, on the other hand, was a most efficient instructor. He returned to the problem at hand.
Perhaps tracking down the human Lorne Pavan would lead him in turn to his primary target. In all probability, the Corellian would have to be killed as well. The longer the Nemoidian was alive, the more likely his information would be disseminated. Still, Maul was not worried. If he had to wipe out this entire city sector in order to contain the news about the blockade, he would do it without a qualm. Lives, even hundreds of lives, did not matter.
7. The first blow came from behind, half-stunning Darsha and causing her to drop to her knees. A booted foot impacted against her side, driving her breath from her. Half-blinded by pain, Darsha reached for the Force as the raptors closed in, felt its power enfold her, cloak her like an invisible shield. She stood, thrusting out one arm in a warding gesture, and felt the reverberating ripples flowing outward, hurling back her surprised attackers. For a brief moment she stood clear of them, and she used that moment to draw and activate the lightsaber. The yellow energy blade boiled out from the hilt's projector, extending to its full length.
"She's a Jedi!" one of the raptors, a Trandoshan, shouted. He seemed surprised, but not particularly awed or impressed.
"She's still dead meat," Greenhair said.
But none of his gang seemed particularly anxious to be the first within reach of the lightsaber.
"You should have listened to me," Darsha said as she moved slowly until her back was against the skyhopper. "I don't want to hurt any of you. Walk away now while you can."
She saw Greenhair and the Trandoshan exchange a glance, just a flicker of eye movement. It was enough to warn her, however, and even if it had not been, she had already sensed the disturbance in the force coming from behind her. Darsha spun and raised the blade in a high defensive movement, just in time to intercept a stocky Gotal who had leapt over the craft, aiming a vibroblade at her. The lightsaber sheared effortlessly through the Gotal's wrist, sending the blade, still clutched in the severed hand, arcing back to land in the empty vehicle. The Gotal shrieked and fell in a heap on the pavement, clutching his cauterized stump. There was a moment of utter stillness, save for the Gotal's whimpers. Events hung in delicate balance, Darsha knew. Would they swarm over her to avenge their comrade or flee in fear? It was Greenhair who decided which course to take. He turned and ran up the street. The rest of the gang members promptly followed his lead, two of them dragging the wounded Gotal with them. In a matter of seconds, the street was completely deserted, save for Darsha and Ulth the Fondorian. Darsha moved quickly to Ulth, who was lying on his back, moaning and still kicking feebly in an effort to dislodge the armored rat. Darsha touched the tip of the lightsaber's blade to the creature's neck, right at the soft juncture between the head and body carapaces, and the rat released its grip and bolted toward the shadows. Darsha deactivated the lightsaber and pulled Ulth to his feet. "Let's go, before they come back with reinforcements."
"What took you so long? That blasted rat nearly gnawed my leg off."
"A pity it wasn't your head," Darsha thought. "Just be grateful I was able to chase them away. Now let's get out of here." She helped him climb into the passenger side of the skyhopper, then settled herself behind the controls, and realized that they weren't going anywhere.
"Come on, what are you waiting for? Lift off."
"I can't." She pointed at the console, where the activated vibroblade, still gripped by the Gotal's severed hand, had sunk to the hilt in the panel. Sparks and smoke were still faintly visible, and she could hear the faint hum of the weapon's high-frequency oscillation. "It's cut through the controls for the stabilizer vanes. We'll spin like a corkscrew if we try to fly in this." Ulth stared at the blade, then at her.
"I don't believe this. Some Jedi you are. You managed to disable your own ship."
Darsha bit back on several scathing replies that came to mind, saying instead,
"It's just a setback. I've got my comlink. I'll just call the temple for..."
She left the sentence unfinished, for as she was speaking, she was reaching into her tunic for her comlink. The moment her fingers touched it, she realized it was unusable as well. The plaque light casing was shattered, no doubt by that kick she had received from one of the raptors. It had probably protected her from a broken rib, although, all things considered, at this point, she would rather have had the injury. Before she could explain this latest reversal to Ulth, the windshield in front of her suddenly cracked in a starburst. Simultaneously, she heard the muffled report of a projectile weapon. Someone, most likely one of the raptors, was shooting at them. Darsha made a quick decision. They would have to abandon the skyhopper. They had to get up levels as quickly as possible. She glanced about them and realized that such an action was easier said than done. Most of the buildings were blocked off above levels 10 or 12. The inhabitants of the upper stories didn't even acknowledge the existence of those lower floors. But they couldn't stay here. As if to underscore that fact, another bolt from the hidden sniper whistled past her ear. They couldn't even take the risk of trying to get back to the safe house. The last light of day was fading fast. Soon it would be full night. Darsha stood up.
"Out of the ship, fast."
She jumped to the pavement, pulling her ascension gun from her utility belt. She fired the grappling hook straight up at maximum length, hoping to strike a ledge or projection above the fog layer. Another blast struck the windshield. Ulth screeched in fear and leapt out of the skyhopper.
"What are you doing? We have to get out of here."
"That's exactly what we're doing," Darsha said as she felt the vibration down the length of the cable, which meant the hook had found purchase.
"Hang on to me."
She grabbed the Fondorian around his waist and thumbed the winding mechanism.
The liquid cable reservoir was good for a maximum of 200 meters, and the tensile strength of the monofilament line would easily support them both. Darsha knew that if they could make it up to the first traffic skylane, around level 20, they could find an air taxi and get back to the temple, or at least find a working comm station from which to call for help. Another bolt caromed off the wall directly beneath them as they rose quickly up past the first level, then the second, then the third. Darsha's arm felt like it was being pulled from its socket. She looked up and estimated that the fog was hovering at around level 10. Once they were enveloped, they would be safe enough from the sniper. A massive shadow flitted past her, followed by several more. In the dimming light, she wasn't sure what they were at first. Then she saw one clearly, and recognition sent a chill of fear through her. Hawk bats. She had never seen one this close before. Their eggs were considered a delicacy. She'd eaten them more than once for the morning meal in the temple. Ordinarily, hawk bats weren't considered dangerous, but she had heard stories of people occasionally being attacked by flocks of the creatures. Evidently, they were very territorial, and danger fell to anyone who ventured too close to one of their rookeries, which apparently was just what she had done. Suddenly, they were enveloped in a shrieking, flapping nightmare of wings, beaks, and talons. Distracted, Darsha buried her head in her shoulder as best she could to protect her eyes. She tried to summon the Force, to use it as a shield against the creatures, but the fierce buffeting of their wings made holding on to the ascension gun the best she could manage. She kept her thumb pressed on the winding control. Their best hope now was to get past the hawk bat's territory. Uth tightened his grip around her chest until she felt in danger of suffocating. She shouted with pain and fear as the winged furies strafed the two of them. The claws on the edges of their leathery wings tore at Darsha's clothes. Her vision was full of beaks and angry ruby eyes. Uth screamed again, louder this time. She glanced down and saw that one of the hawk bats had landed on his shoulder and was savagely pecking at his face. The beak scored his cheek, drawing a line of dark blood across his skin. Darsha felt his grip lessen. She saw another hawk bat clinging to Uth's arm, stabbing at his hand with its beak. "Hang on," she shouted. "We're almost through this." Uth cried out again, louder than all his previous cries. Darsha looked down at him, saw that one of the hawk bats had hooked its cruel beak into his right eye. Mad with pain, the Fondorian let go of her, raising both hands to push away his winged tormentor. "No!" Darsha shouted, trying to hang on to him with her free hand. But his weight was too much. His shirt tore, leaving a swatch of it in her grip as he dropped with a trailing cry down into the darkness. Darsha knew there was no point in trying to go after him, even if there was any way it could be accomplished. She was 7 or 8 levels up now, and the fall had undoubtedly been fatal. A moment later, she entered the fog level, but the hawk bats showed no sign of lessening their attack. Already her skin was cut and torn in a score of wounds. At this rate, she wouldn't survive to reach the upper levels. Only one course of action promised even a faint hope of survival. Each level that slipped by her had a line of dark windows. Darsha released the winding control and drew her lightsaber. As her ascent slowed and then stopped, she swung the energy blade, melting a large hole through the transparent steel of the window next to her. She got a foot on the ledge beneath it and tumbled through, releasing the ascension gun as she fell forward into darkness. She turned the fall into a shoulder roll, holding the lightsaber away from her, as she had been taught to avoid self-inflicted injury. She came to her feet, the weapon held ready to defend herself against the hawk bats. But apparently there was no need. None of them pursued her into the building. Slowly, Darsha abandoned her fighting stance. She looked around, trying to take stock of her surroundings. It was fully dark outside now. The broken window was merely a patch of lesser darkness. The lightsaber's coherent light beam didn't vouchsafe much in the way of illumination. Darsha listened, both with her ears and with the Force. No sound and no sense of danger. For the moment, she seemed to be safe. Of course, that depended on one's definition of safe. She was trapped in the abandoned lower levels of a building in the infamous Crimson Corridor. She had no comlink and no transportation. Worse still, she had failed in her mission. The man she had been sent to save now lay dead in the street far below. If this was safe, Darsha thought grimly, maybe she ought to consider another line of work. Assuming she made it back alive.
8.
Lorne awoke feeling like a herd of banthas had stampeded over him. He risked opening one eye. The light in the cubicle was very dim, but even so it felt like a blaster beam had fired straight into his eye and up the optic nerve to his brain. He groaned, hastily shut the eye, and wrapped both arms around his head for good measure. Somewhere in the darkness he heard I-5 say, "Ah, the beast awakes."
"Stop shouting," he mumbled.
"My vocabulator is modulated at a medium level of 60 decibels, which is standard for normal human conversation. Of course, your hearing might be a trifle oversensitive, given the amount of alcohol still in your bloodstream."
Lorne groaned and tried unsuccessfully to burrow into the sleeping pad.
"If you're going to continue such behavior," I-5 went on remorselessly, "I suggest having a few healthy liver cells removed, if indeed you have any left, and cryogenically stored, since you may need that particular organ cloned in the near future. I can recommend a very good MD-5 medical droid of my acquaintance."
"All right, all right."
Lorne sat up, cradling his aching head in his hands, and glared at the droid.
"You've had your fun. Now make it go away."
The droid feigned polite incomprehension.
"Make it go away? I'm just a lowly droid. How could I possibly?"
"Do it, or I'll reprogram your cognitive module with Bilk's blaster." I-5 gave a remarkably human-like sigh.
"Of course, I live to serve."
The droid paused for a moment, then there issued from his vocabulator a low trilling tone. It warbled up and down the scale, seeming to resonate in the small cubicle. Lorne sat in the bed and let the sound wash over him, let it reverberate in his head. After a few minutes, the headache began to lessen its iron grip, as did his nausea and general malaise. He wasn't sure exactly how the wordless song of the droid accomplished it, but something about the vibrations made it the best hangover cure he had ever come across. But no cure comes without a price, and Lorne knew that the price of this one would be having to put up with I-5's smug superiority for most of the day. It was still worth it. When I-5 finally let the sound trail off, Lorne felt remarkably better. He wouldn't be doing any zero-G calisthenics at the Null Grav Spa over at Trantor Center today, but at least he could think of doing them someday soon without feeling like throwing up. He looked at I-5 and found himself wondering once again how a droid with only one fixed facial expression and limited body language could manage to look so disapproving.
"Are we all better now?" I-5 inquired with mock solicitousness.
"Let's just say I'm willing to hold off on that reprogramming, for today at least." Lorne stood up, somewhat carefully, as his head still felt like it might topple off his neck if he moved too quickly.
"Your gratitude overwhelms me,
and your sarcasm underwhelms me." Lorne went into the refresher, splashed cold water on his face, and ran an ultrasound cleaner over his teeth.
"I might actually be able to be in the same room with some food," he said as he came out.
"Time enough for that. First, I think you should have a look at these messages that came in while you were comatose."
"What messages?"
It was too much to hope that Zippa had decided to sell him the holocron after all. Nevertheless, he knew I-5 wouldn't have bothered keeping the communication unless it was important.
"These messages," the droid replied patiently, and activated the message unit.
A flickering image of an enormous blubbery body formed in midair over the unit. Lorne recognized Yanth the Hutt.
"Lorne," the image said in a deep voice, "I thought we were going to meet sometime today to discuss a certain holocron you wished me to look at. It's not polite to keep buyers waiting, you know."
The image dissolved. "Thanks," Lorne said to I-5. "If you're not too busy later, I've got a scraped knuckle you could rub some salt into."
"I think your attitude may change when you see the next message."
The second image materialized above the projector. It wasn't Zippa or Yanth. That much was immediately evident. After a moment, Lorne recognized the species, a Nemoidian. That in itself was surprising. The masters of the Trade Federation were rarely seen on Coruscant,
given the current strained relationship between their organization and the Republic Senate. The Nemoidian glanced around furtively before leaning in close and speaking softly.
Lorne Pavan, your name was mentioned to me as someone who can be discreet in handling sensitive information,
he said in the gurgling tones of his kind.
I wish to discuss a matter that could be very profitable to both of us. If you are interested, meet me at the Dubak Inn at 0900. Tell no one of this.
The three-dimensional image winked out.
Play it again, Lorne said.
I-5 complied, and Lorne watched the message a second time, paying more attention to the Nemoidian's body language than to what he was saying. He wasn't all that familiar with Nemoidian mannerisms, but it didn't take an interplanetary psychoanalyst to see that the alien was as nervous as a henanthe groom, which could mean trouble, but which could also mean profit. In his present line of work, Lorne seldom saw the second happen without having to wade through the first. He pressed a button that deleted the second message and glanced at I-5.
What do you think? I think we have 17 Republic desecreds in the bank, and whatever change might have fallen under the sleeping pad. I think the rent is due in a week. I think,
I-5 said,
that we should talk to this Nemoidian.
I think so, too, Lorne said.
The time of the evening meal was almost over. Maui Lin had by now investigated 4 restaurants whose menus included Nemoidian cuisine. Only one of them was occupied by a Nemoidian at table, a female. Lin had questioned her, but she had professed no knowledge of a countryman named Hath Monchar. She had, however, told Lin of another eatery in the area that her kind had been known to frequent. It was a small tavern called the Dubak Inn, one of the few drinking establishments in the sector that featured agaric ale, a beverage most Nemoidians were extremely fond of. Lin decided to check it out.
It had not been terribly difficult to find Lorne Pavan's dwelling cubicle. As Darth Maul approached it, he saw the door open. A human and a droid, the latter one of the protocol series, emerged. Maul quickly faded back into the shadows of the underground thoroughfare and watched them pass. Both matched the descriptions he had been given by the Baragwin bartender. Excellent. With any luck, they would lead him to his prey. He followed them at a safe distance, making use of shadows and concealment when it was available, and trusting to the cloaking power of the Force when it was not. The human and his droid had no idea they were being followed. He would tail them until they contacted the Nemoidian, and then he would take what action was appropriate. Maul could feel the dark side surging within him, filling him with impatience, urging him to complete this assignment as quickly as possible.
This is not what you were trained for, he thought. These are not prey worthy of your abilities.
He tried to dismiss these thoughts, for they were heretical. His master had given him this assignment. That was all that mattered. But he could not help chafing at this duty. There was no real challenge to his abilities in it. He had been bred and trained to fight and kill Jedi, after all, not rank-and-file beings like these. The Jedi, how he hated them, how he loathed their hollow sanctimoniousness, their pretense of piety, their hypocrisy. How he longed for the day when their temple would be a ruin of smoking rubble littered with their crushed corpses. If he closed his eyes, he could see the apocalypse of the Order as vividly as if it were reality. It was reality, after all. A future reality, but nonetheless valid. It was destined, ordained, predetermined. And he would be instrumental in bringing it about. It was what his entire life had been designed for. Not tracking some pathetic failure through the slums of Coruscant. Maul shook his head and snarled silently. His purpose was to serve his master, no matter what the assignment was. If Darth Sidious knew he was having such doubts, the Sith Lord would severely punish him, such as he had not been punished since he was a child. And Maul would not resist, even though he was now a grown man, because Sidious would be right to do so. The human and his droid emerged from the underground thoroughfare and proceeded along the narrow surface streets. It was late at night, but the planetary city never slept. The streets were crowded no matter what time of day or night it was.
This was fortunate in that it made it easier for Maul to keep his quarry in sight without being noticed. It would not be much longer, Maul told himself. He would bring this job to a successful conclusion, and then perhaps Darth Sidious would reward him with a task more worthy of his abilities. Something like the Black Sun assignment. That had been a challenge he had enjoyed. Pavan and his droid turned down another street, this one so narrow and bounded by tall structures that there was barely room for two lanes of foot traffic. They entered a doorway under a hanging sign decorated with a rampant dewback. This was their destination, then. Despite his near-perfect control of his nervous system, Maul felt his pulse quicken slightly in anticipation. If all went as planned, soon this onerous chore would be over. He entered the tavern. 9. Lorne looked around the dingy, ill-lit interior. The Dewback Inn was even less reputable-looking than the Glowstone, and that was saying something. There weren't many customers, but each one that he noticed looked like he or she or it had seen their share of combat. Lorne noticed a Deveronian with one horn missing, a piebald Wookiee, half of whose hair had apparently been singed off, a Sakian whose bald head was stitched with ridged keloid tissue, among others. I-5 surveyed the room as well. "It just keeps getting better," the droid said. Lorne noticed a sign above the bar that read, "No droids allowed," in basic. He also noticed several of the patrons looking suspiciously at I-5. "I think you'd better wait outside," he told the droid. "Sorry." "I think I can deal with the rejection." I-5 went back outside. Lorne saw a Nemoidian sitting alone at a corner table, looking very uncomfortable. As he started to make his way through the tables, he heard the door open behind him, and out of the corner of his eye, he glimpsed a cloaked and hooded form entering. The newcomer had a sinister aspect about him, but then, with the possible exception of the Nemoidian, so did everyone else in the room. So Lorne didn't give the new arrival much thought. As he drew near the Nemoidian's table, he felt his arms seized abruptly in an iron grasp. "Hey!" He tried to pull free, but his assailant, a Trandoshan, was far stronger than he was. His struggles alerted the Nemoidian, who looked up. "Are you Lorne Pavan?" he asked. "That's me. Call off your bully boy." The Nemoidian made a gesture. "Release him, Garth." The Trandoshan let Lorne go. Lorne pulled back a chair and sat down, rubbing his arms, both of which had gone somewhat numb from the reptilian being's grip. "I do apologize," the Nemoidian said, his gaze darting here and there about the bar as he spoke. "You can understand my desire to have some protection in a place like this. Garth comes highly recommended." "I can see why," Lorne said. "Let's get down to business. What do you have?" As Darth Maul slipped into the rat hole called the Dewback Inn, he kept his cowl up and moved to the darkest corner. When one of the weak minds surrounding him caused its owner to idly cast a glance in his direction, he used the Force to squelch or redirect that interest. As always, when he wished it in such dens of mental weakness, he was effectively invisible. He had spotted his prey immediately. The urge to simply step up and sever the Nemoidian's head from his body was tempting, but he knew that would be foolishness. He would have to kill the big Trandoshan bodyguard first, and probably the Corellian as well. Slaying 3 people, even in a pit such as this, would not go unnoticed. Calling attention to oneself in a public place would be bad. His master had impressed that upon Maul at an early age. The Sith were powerful, but there were only 2 of them. Stealth was therefore one of their greatest strengths. Even as weak-minded and chemically besotted as most of the patrons of this place were, there were simply too many to control completely. He could not wipe the memories of a cold-blooded assassination from several dozen heads, nor could he be sure of destroying all of them. And here and there burned an intellect too strong to be swayed by simple mind-control techniques. These he could feel. They stood out like photonic lamps on a darkling plain. And besides all that, he had to question the Nemoidian thoroughly to find any others the traitor might have tainted in his flight. Nevertheless, Maul had his target in sight now.
That was what was important, and it would now be only a matter of time before he was able to close the assignment. He would wait for a propitious moment to deal with him. The human dealer in information was speaking with the doomed Nemoidian, and likely that sealed the man's fate as well. Later, when he questioned Hath Manchar, Maul would determine precisely what had passed between the man and the Nemoidian. If this Lorne Pavan had come to discuss other matters and knew nothing of Manchar's treachery, he would be allowed to keep his insignificant life. But if he had become party to the subversion, then the human would die. Quite simple.
Maui Lin trekked through the back streets and alleys, searching for the Dubak Inn. She was certainly not over-impressed with this area of Coruscant. The surface streets in this sector were all twisted turnings and narrow byways, teeming with gutter scum looking for an easy mark. Lin, armed to the teeth as she was, did not present such an easy target, and the strong-armed thieves and head-bashers watched her pass, but stayed on their own ground, smart enough to recognize danger when they saw it. Lin wasn't particularly worried about her safety. She had been in much worse places than this and survived. It was largely a matter of attitude. She projected confidence and an air of danger as she walked, an aura that made it clear that, at the first sign of trouble from any of this riffraff, the troublemaker would find his, her, or itself a smoking corpse on the greasy walkway to be quickly picked over by the rest of them. She came to an intersection, hesitated briefly, then chose the right fork. Another person could easily get lost and stay lost in this maze, but Maui Lin had honed her sense of direction in scores of such places around the galaxy, and she knew she would eventually arrive at her destination. She always got where she was supposed to go, and she always came out on top when she got there. She was, quite simply, the best at what she did, as Hath Manchar would soon find out. After climbing a few flights of stairs, Darsha Asant reached the lowest inhabited levels of the building. Here she found what passed for a pharmacy at the end of a squalid corridor. She had lost her regular credit tab along the way, though she still had her emergency tab. It was good for only a small amount, not nearly enough to rent a speeder, unfortunately, but sufficient to purchase enough antibiotic synth flesh bandage to treat and seal her wounds and even hire a taxi, if it didn't have to go far. Her robes were in pretty sad shape as well, but the emergency fund was not up to covering replacements for those. No matter, she had more important things to worry about than her wardrobe. Feeling somewhat better, after she smoothed the healing synth flesh into place, she looked for a quiet spot, preferably one with walls to protect her back and sides, to ponder what she should do next. There was no way to sugarcoat her situation. She was quite simply ruined. She had lost her charge. The hawk bats were no doubt picking clean the Fondorian's bones by now. She had lost her transportation to a common street gang. Her comlink was shattered. The mission, in short, had been a complete and utter disaster. Master Bondura had been right to wonder about her ability. Darsha sat down on a graffiti-scarred bench and sought to center herself as she had been taught. It was no use. The stillness that a Jedi should always operate from was nowhere to be found. Instead, she felt grief, sadness, anger, but most of all, she felt shame. She had disgraced herself, her mentor, and her heritage. She would never become a Jedi Knight now. Her life as she had known it, as she had expected it to be, was over. Maybe it would have been better to have died, to have been eaten by the hawk bats. At least she would not have to face Master Bondura, not have to see the disappointment in her mentor's eyes. What was she going to do? She could find a public comm station. Some of them would work, even down here, and call for help. The Council would send a Jedi, a real Jedi, she thought bitterly, to come and fetch her. She would be escorted back, as if she were a child, taken into custody so that she could do no more damage. She envisioned entering the temple with such an escort. That would be all that was needed to make her shame complete. Darsha clenched her jaw muscles. No, that wasn't how it was going to be. She had failed her mission, true enough, but she still had her lightsaber, and she still had some pride, if only a trace of what it had been. She would not call for help. She could find some way to return to the Council under her own power. She owed that much, at least, to Master Bondura.
and to herself. She took a deep breath, let it escape slowly, and once again sought calmness in the Force. Her path as a Jedi Knight was done. There was no way to change that, but she could deliver herself to that judgment without begging for help. She stood, took another deep breath, and blew it out. Yes, at the very least, she could do that much. Lorne could not believe his luck. Finally, it looked like things were taking a turn for the better. Carefully, so as not to reveal his enthusiasm, he said to the Nemoidian, "And you say you have recorded all this information? The details of the impending blockade and the fact that the Sith are behind it on a holocron?" "That is correct," Monshar replied. "And may I, see this crystal?" Monshar gave Lorne a look that was plain to read, even given the differences between Nemoidian and human facial expressions. "What am I, stupid?" Aloud, he said, "I would not carry it around on my person in such places, even with Gorth as a protector. The holocron is safely stored and guarded elsewhere." Lorne leaned back. "I see. And you would want to sell it for... how much?" "500,000 Republic credits." Lorne grinned. The way to play this was cool and easy. "500,000? Why, sure. You have change for a 1,000,000 cred note?" The Nemoidian gave Lorne a fishy smile in return.
"I'm afraid not."
Lorne had played this game before, and he knew it was time to palaver. "All right," he said. "If it is what you say it is, I might be willing to go 250,000.
"Don't insult me," Monshar replied. "If it is what I say it is, and I assure you it is, the information on that crystal is worth twice what I am asking, more in the right hands. We will not dicker like a couple of Bantha traders, human. 500,000 credits, period. You'll stand to make that much and more off it if you have the wits of a Sarconian green flea."
That was true, Lorne knew. Of course, if he could lay his hands on 500,000 creds, he wouldn't be sitting in this dive trying to negotiate stolen data. But there was no way he could let a deal like this pass. He might never see another like it. "All right, 500,000. Where shall we make the exchange?" The Nemoidian touched a button on a wristband, and a small holographic projection lit up just above the surface of the table, no bigger than Lorne's thumb.
"Here's the address of my cubicle," Monshar said. "Meet me there in an hour. Come alone."
1 hour. Lorne kept his expression carefully noncommittal. I might need a little longer than that to raise the funds.
1 hour, Monshar repeated. "If you cannot procure funding by then, I will seek others who are more capable. I am told there is a hut, Yanth by name, who would be most interested in this commodity."
"I know Yanth. You don't want to deal with him. He's shiftier than a crystal snake."
"Then bring me the money, and we will consummate this transaction."
Lorne memorized the address and nodded. Monshar shut the hollow off. "Okay, no problem," Lorne said. "I'll see you in an hour." He stood and wended his way toward the door. Outside, I-5 was waiting.
"Well," the droid said as they walked down the narrow street.
Lorne explained quickly as they walked. "So we've got an hour, actually 55 minutes, to raise 500,000 credits. He looked at the droid.
"Any thoughts?" "It is an excellent opportunity, to be sure. In fact, it might well be the chance of your lifetime, though I expect to have better opportunities myself, since I will probably outlive you by a factor of 7.4 to 7.6 at a conservative estimate, disallowing major accidents, natural disasters, or acts of war."
"We're on the chrono and you're discussing actuarial tables. The big question is, where are we going to get 500,000 credits in less than an hour?"
"That is indeed the question."
"We could find a card game. I'm good at sabacc."
"But not consistently. If you were, we wouldn't be in this situation. And since we have no money of which to speak, who in all of the underground would give us enough of a marker to buy into a sufficiently high-stakes game?"
"Offhand, I'd say nobody," Lorne admitted.
"And how long would it take to win such an amount, assuming you could get into such a game, even if you cheated and were not caught,
Could you do it in 52 minutes? Not counting, of course, transit time to the Nemoidian's domicile.
All right, Sabac is not a viable option. I assume you've got a better idea.
I-5 cleared his speaking circuits in what sounded almost like a human cough.
There is only one viable option. Bank fraud.
Lauren stopped to stare at I-5. A given blundered into him, muttered an apology, and kept going. Without taking his gaze from I-5, Lauren grabbed the given's exoskeleton, pulled him back, and retrieved his wallet. He then shoved the pickpocket away.
I'm listening, he told the droid.
I have been considering this idea for some time, I-5 said, keeping it in reserve as a final contingency plan. If we effect it, we will be forced to flee Coruscant, and it would be unlikely that we could ever return, unless we wish to radically change our appearances and spend the rest of our lives looking over our shoulders.
If we had 1,000,000 credits in our account, that would take us a long, long way from here, Lauren said, and I'd be happy to leave.
We could set up shop on some outlier world where the Republic doesn't have a presence, make a few smart investments, live like kings. Tell me about this plan.
They continued to walk while I-5 elaborated. They wouldn't really be able to steal the money, but the droid was confident he could jack into the data flow of one of Coruscant's many banking firms and manage a phantom transfer of funds into their personal account. The auditor droids would catch it almost immediately, so timing would be critical. But if all went well, Lauren would be able to show Half Monshar an unencumbered credit tab that was worth 500,000. Much more than that, the droid explained, would kick in automatic inquiries, and if they tried to transfer the funds after the audit, the bank would catch that too. The real trick would be to have the Nemoidian accept the credit tab as payment and make the transfer to his account before time ran out.
The window will be narrow and it will close quickly, I-5 concluded, but in theory it can be done.
Lauren felt a warm rush of excitement. They might actually pull this off, and if they did, they could walk away with a holocron worth 1,000,000 creds and leave the Nemoidian holding an empty bag. Which would be too bad for him, but that's how life was in the real galaxy. Lorne wouldn't stay awake nights worrying about it, that was for sure.
Let's do it, he said. If it doesn't work, we won't be any worse off than we are now.
Save for the distinct possibility of you occupying a cell in a Republic asteroid prison for 30 years, and me having a complete memory wipe.
You worry too much.
And you don't worry enough.
But Lauren knew I-5 would take the risk. Droids were supposed to be programmed with more integrity and honesty than humans and other natural-born species, but it didn't always work quite like that. I-5 had somehow evolved a greed circuit along the way, and the glitter of credits called to him as much as it did Lauren, which was one of the reasons they got along so well. Lauren felt an excitement he hadn't known in years as he contemplated it. It would work, and they would use the money to build a new life out on the rim. There were plenty of worlds where, with enough money, one could disappear into a new identity and live a life of ease with no questions asked. A new life. A real life this time. Maybe not the one he had before, but certainly a better one than this hard-scrabble existence he was suffering through now. Of course, it would mean leaving behind any possibility of ever seeing Jax again.
So what? A savage voice in the back of his head asked. Like there's any chance at all of that now? That's in the past. It's time you started living again.
Yes. Far past time, in fact.
He looked at I-5, and though there was no expression on the droid's metallic countenance, he felt certain that I-5 knew exactly what he was thinking.
What are we waiting for? He asked the droid.
The Hutt's still expecting us to bring him a holocron.
Why disappoint him? Let's find a data port and make it happen.
10. The gods of fortune smiled upon Maui Lin. Just as she arrived at the Dubak Inn, she saw the Nemoidian depart in the company of a hulking brute of a Trandoshan. The big reptiloid with Monshar sported a pair of blasters, one on each hip, and moved like a bodyguard, which undoubtedly he was. Lin reviewed her options. This was too public a place to take out the guard and collect Monshar, so she'd just have to follow them until circumstances were more viable.
She stepped into a narrow aperture between two buildings and let them pass. She was about to fall in behind at a safe distance when someone else emerged from the inn, a robed and cowled figure, bipedal and human-sized, who slipped into the shadow of a doorway across the alley. Lynn didn't get a look at the face, but whoever he was obviously interested in Monchar. Lynn quickly moved behind a stanchion and out of sight. A footpad bent on robbery, she wondered, as she watched. Whoever he was, he had to be pretty sure of himself if he was willing to take on an armed bodyguard. Sure enough, the robed figure followed the Nemoidian and the Trandoshan, keeping to the dimly lit areas and moving with a stealth that Lynn had to admire. If this fellow could shoot half as well as he could tail, he could drill the Trandoshan and be on the Nemoidian in a hurry. Lynn frowned and loosened her own DL-44s in their holsters. This job was threatening to become complicated. She decided the best course was to take out the bodyguard and the mysterious robed tracker as quickly as possible. If she had to, she could use a glop grenade on Monchar, seal him up in a gel bubble, and haul him back to Gunray like that, though she didn't think it would be necessary. She'd never met a brave Nemoidian, never even heard of one, and she didn't think Hath Monchar would prove the exception to the rule. Darth Maul melded with the darkness, becoming a shade among shadows, a ghost in the fetid gloom. It was always night this deep in the Ferrocrete Canyons. Artificial lights were few and far between at best, and there were many places where lights were burned out, stolen, or shattered by vandals. He had plenty of cover, and the lumbering pair in front of him had no idea they were being followed. Now and again the bodyguard would glance around to assure himself that no threat drew close, but it was obvious that he was an oaf without skill or much training. Maul did not need to use the dark side to hide from such a being. As he surveilled the Nemoidian and his guard, however, Maul felt a small prickling of something. Not real danger, but a kind of disquiet touch his awareness. He looked about and listened carefully, but did not see any cause for this. He expanded his consciousness, let the dark currents of the Force extend outward from him, and became aware of another presence behind him, hidden from normal sight and hearing. Probably just another of the many predators in this dreary place, looking for prey. Now that he was aware of the presence, Maul dismissed it. He felt no real concentrations of the Force emanating from the hidden watcher, and thus whoever he was and whatever his reasons for being here, he did not pose a threat. The Nemoidian and his guard took a convoluted path, turning and twisting back, until finally they arrived at a block of small cubic living units stacked a dozen high and 20 wide, and probably that many deep. The pair entered the building through a locked durasteel door that Monchar opened with his thumbprint. Maul waited a few moments, then approached the door. Maui Lin was a bit slow in arriving at the domicile. Though she couldn't put her finger on the exact reason why, she felt sure the robed stalker tailing the Nemoidian had somehow known he was being tailed in turn. Lin didn't think she'd been seen, and she'd moved with as much stealth as she could muster, which was considerable. But the feeling had persisted, and as a result she had dropped back. She was trusting that the lurker in the cowl wouldn't lose Monchar, and so she let the Nemoidian and his bodyguard get far enough ahead that she couldn't see them. It was risky business to track a tracker, and not the primary subject, but she didn't see that she had much choice. Given all that, by the time she got closer, the Nemoidian and the bodyguard were already inside, or so she assumed, and the tracker in the cowl was just arriving at the door. There came a sudden flash of light, the source of which was hidden by the tracker's body. Lynn ducked back behind a garbage bin as the light strobed. When she looked again, the door was wide open, and the cowled figure was nowhere in sight. Lynn pulled her left blaster, keeping her right hand clear to use the palm flechette shooter. The quieter, and therefore preferable, weapon. She hurried across the dim street. When she reached the door, she paused in surprise. Where the locking mechanism had been on the durasteel plate was a still-smoking semicircular hole, its glowing edges carved as cleanly as if done by laser surgery. The lock and handle lay on the ground, also smoldering from whatever tool had cut them free. Lynn knew of only a couple of devices that could excise a thick slab of durasteel so fast and smoothly. A plasma torch, which was much too big to hide under a cloak and haul around, or a lightsaber. and the only people she knew of who used lightsabers were Jedi. Lynn swallowed dryly, her belly suddenly roiling. If the Jedi were somehow involved, the risk factor had just shot off the scale. A Jedi Knight was nobody to mess with. You'd get only one shot at taking out a Jedi who was paying attention. After that, you'd likely be sliced apart real quick. Lynn had once seen a Jedi knock a blaster bolt out of the air using a lightsaber. That required inhumanly fast reflexes. For a second, she seriously considered turning around and heading for the spaceport. Hacko hadn't said anything about Jedi. But no. She was a professional, trained, and adept. She couldn't have word getting around that she had backed away from a job, no matter what the reason. She didn't know for certain that the cowled stalker was a Jedi. Besides, for all their battle skill, she had heard that Jedi did not kill unless there was absolutely no alternative, although she would hate to be in a position where she had to rely on that. She was just going to have to take it very slowly and carefully from here on. Very slowly and carefully. Lorne and I-5 walked down the narrow street toward their destination, keeping to the middle so as to avoid being surprised by a robber looking for a quick knockover. Lorne had a small blaster in his tunic's pocket, gripped in his right hand, which he noticed was somewhat sweaty. The idea of living on a planet where you didn't have to worry about such things every time you stepped outside was most appealing. And seeing things under the natural light of a sun was a novel concept, too. They'd been down here far too long. It was definitely time for a change. "So the scam transfer went all right?" he asked I-5. "For the 7th time, yes, it went all right. We have precisely 1 hour and 26 minutes before it's discovered and rectified by the auditor droids. Perhaps another 4 minutes before they are able to pinpoint the location of the credit tab, and depending on how busy the local police are, anywhere from 6 to 14 minutes before they arrive to take the bearer of the tab into custody for attempted grand theft and illegal use of communication protocols THX-113. "Spare me the details. We have less than 1 hour and 45 minutes to get this deal done and be on our way. How much farther is this place?"
"At our present rate of speed, we'll arrive in 2.6 minutes, plenty of time to accomplish our task, as well as fence the holocron to the hut."
Assuming the Nemoidian doesn't want to have a drink and chat about Republic politics and the latest high-low ball scores.
"Since you are to negotiate alone, I trust you will find some way to skip the small talk. Time's running out, and the fake ID I utilized on the transfer won't slow the authorities for more than another few minutes after they collect the credit tab." "That's assuming Hath Monshar doesn't give your name to the arresting officers, which would be a dangerous assumption, for if I were him, I would do so instantly, and so would you to anybody who cheated you thus. In which case, we will be in bantha excrement up to our eyeballs and photoreceptors, respectively. So decline liquid refreshment and idle chit-chat, and get the deal done. That's my considered advice."
Finding the Nemoidian was child's play for Maul. Walls could not stop the dark-questing fingers of the Force. When he arrived at the correct domicile, he sensed that there were 4 beings behind the door. Monshar, of course, and the bodyguard he had seen accompanying him. The dull ripples of the other 2 rumbled with suppressed violence. More guards, no doubt. No matter, be there 3 guards or 30, the result would be the same. It was time for Hath Monshar to pay the penalty for attempting to double-cross Lord Sidious. Darth Maul pulled his double saber from his belt and held his thumb upon the ignition button. He took a deep breath and centered himself in the swirls and eddies of the dark side. Then, his power and concentration thus augmented, he thrust forward his free hand as though hurling an invisible ball. The door shattered inward. Maui Lin moved through the building's dimly lit halls with great care, ready to shoot anything that moved. A door opened, and an old human woman started to step out, saw Lin with her finger tightening on the trigger, and launched herself back into the room, slamming the hinged door behind her. Lin managed to keep from blasting her, though just barely. This could be a problem, she reflected. There were hundreds of rooms in this hive, and no way that she could search them all. Her plan had been to follow the cowled one to their common destination, but her few moments of shock at discovering the way the other had breached the entrance had been enough to let her quarry vanish into the warren. Lynn knew she could wander around here for days and not find the Nemoidian. Maybe she should go back outside and set up a watch on the building's exit? The problem with that was she wasn't sure of the Culled One's intent in pursuing Monchar. Lynn's mandate from the Trade Federation was clear. Bring Hath Monchar back alive. If she didn't find the Nemoidian soon, she might wind up with a corpse on her hands, which would not make Hacko at all happy. There didn't seem to be much choice but to continue her search. As soon as he was through the door, Maul triggered his lightsaber. The bright beams lanced out to their full lengths. He took in the room. The Nemoidian sat in a chair against the far wall. A pair of squid heads scrabbled for their holstered blasters. The Trandoshan bodyguard already had his out, and now he fired it. Maul spun the lightsaber and angled it slightly. Stopping the blast fire was easy. Redirecting it properly was a bit more difficult, but certainly not impossible. The bolt bounced from the potent energy lance and ricocheted into the nearest squid head, striking him on the thorax. The Quarren collapsed. Maul allowed himself a slight frown. The deflected beam was 2 centimeters lower than he had aimed. Poor control on his part. A second blaster bolt from the Trandoshan seared its way at him, and another quick shift guided by the dark side caught that bolt and returned it to the center. The Trandoshan took the deflected beam in the face. He went down, twitching in his death throes, his face a blackened ruin of flesh and scales, at the horrified Nemoidian's feet. Better. Maul leapt at the remaining Quarren, who had his blaster halfway up. The squidhead fired a panicked round, far too low to do any damage save to the floor. Then the lightsaber arced, and with a snap of his wrists, Maul lopped the Quarren's tentacled head from his neck. The battle had begun and ended far too quickly for the Nemoidian to even think about running. He cowered in the chair, hands uselessly raised to ward off danger. He didn't even have a weapon. Maul shut the lightsaber off and hooked it back on his belt. He spared a contemptuous glance at the 3 corpses. His dueling droids had given him a better fight than these 3 had. Pitiful. He turned toward the terrified Nemoidian. Slowly he raised his gloved hands and slipped his cowl back and off, revealing his frightening visage. He smiled, showing his teeth, adding to the effect. A pungent reek became noticeable over the stench of death in the room. The Nemoidian's bladder sack had let go its contents. "Hath Monchar," Darth Maul said. "We have things to discuss, you and I." As Lorne and I-5 reached the cube complex, the droid said, "Approximately 1 hour and 33 minutes left. Speed is of the essence. As it is, even assuming the meeting with the Hutt goes smoothly, the police will probably be searching for us while we're en route to the spaceport." "Don't worry about me. Just you be ready to..." "Hey, what happened to the door?" "It appears to have had a disagreement with somebody," I-5 said. "Not a big surprise in this neighborhood. In any event, that's not our concern, is it? Now hurry." Lorne nodded and entered the building. In the small lobby, he paged the lift tube to take him to the 4th level, where the Nemoidian supposedly had a residence. Monchar must be low on funds to be staying in a dive such as this, or perhaps trying very hard not to be noticed. Either way, the quicker Lorne could make the exchange and leave, the happier he'd be. He kept his grip on the blaster in his pocket and tried to look nonchalant as he waited for the lift tube to arrive. Nonchalant was hard to pull off at this juncture. The credit tab in his wallet felt like it was made of fissionable material. It wasn't every day he tried to scam a 1,000,000-credit deal. Caught in the power of the dark side, the Nemoidian struggled to breathe. Maul's left hand, raised before him, tightened into a fist, and the Nemoidian's throat constricted even more. "Ready to talk?" Maul asked. The Nemoidian could not speak, but he managed a nod. The crimson sclera of his eyes had darkened several shades due to blood congestion. Maul relaxed his fist and his concentration. Hath Monchar collapsed on the floor, wheezing as he tried to suck in a breath. "Who else knows?"
No one, except a human, Lorne Pavan."
Maul sensed the truth of Monchar's words. This was good. All he had to do was kill the Nemoidian, then find the human and kill him, and then this dreary chore would be at an end.
"Where can I find the human now?"
"I don't know." Maul's hand clenched again. Monchar choked, gasping once more for air. Maul released him.
Where? He's coming here to buy the holocron. When? Any time now.
Maul smiled. He had all the information he needed.
Excellent. You have been most cooperative, Hath Manchar.
Manchar looked up from his supine position. There was an instant of hope in his eyes, but it died when he read his fate in Maul's expression. Maul drew his lightsaber.
Time to die, he said.
Wait!
The Nemordian's voice was a bleat of fear.
I can pay you. Every credit the human gives me will be yours. Please.
Stand up, Maul said. You can at least meet your fate without groveling.
But Manchar was too palsied with terror to comply. Maul felt a wave of disgust for the cringing creature. With his free hand, he made a sharp upward gesture, and the Nemoidian was lifted like a puppet on strings. He hung, helpless in the Force's grasp.
No!
Darth Maul lit one blade of the lightsaber and swung it laterally, cutting off the Nemoidian's final wail along with his head. He then released the lines of Force that held the twitching body and watched it crumple. There was a Durasteel safe on the floor behind the body. Maul opened it with a careful swipe of his lightsaber.
Ah, there was the holocron crystal of which Manchar had spoken. He extinguished his lightsaber, hung it on his belt, and bent to pick up the holocron.
Before his fingers touched it, however, he sensed that he was not alone.
Don't move, came a voice from the door, even as he realized this. You so much as breathe deep and I'll fry you where you stand.
Maul glanced at the doorway. A tall human female in shell spider silk armor stood there, aiming a pair of blasters at him. Maul realized that this was the same being he had sensed following him earlier. His lips twitched in annoyance. He tried a quick mental probe, but the bounty hunter, for surely that was what she was too sharp, her attention too focused, to fall for mind tricks. Maul considered his options. He would never reach his lightsaber fast enough, even as quick as he was. He might be able to dodge a single blast, maybe even two, but hemmed in as he was in this small cubicle against a woman who could likely put a dozen bolts into the air from two semi-automatic blasters in half a second, he would have to have a distraction. Near his feet lay the Trandoshan's blaster. It would serve nicely. Using his control of the Force, Darth Maul gripped the weapon in a dark tentacle of energy and hurled it at the bounty hunter's face, hard. The woman was fast. She dodged the blaster, firing a bolt at it. She missed and recovered, but the distraction had served its purpose. Before the weapon had bounced off the wall and landed on the floor, Maul had the lightsaber in his grasp. He thumbed on both blades as the next blaster bolt and half a dozen more came his way in rapid succession. The Sith apprentice's hands were a blur as he let the dark side take him over completely, giving into its power and allowing it to control and manipulate him. Blaster bolts struck the lightsaber's spinning blades and were deflected into the walls, the ceiling, the floor. No time to aim, though a bolt or two did hit the bounty hunter without apparent effect. Her armor was apparently state-of-the-art. The bounty hunter dropped her useless blasters and reached for one wrist, where she wore a rocket launcher. The fool, Maul thought grimly. If a rocket exploded in here, it would kill them both. There was no time to try to stop her. Maul slipped along the lines of the Force, moving at unnatural speed as he spun toward the nearest wall, a cheap plastic panel twirling the lightsaber in a cutting pattern. The plastic shredded easily before the blade's super-hot plasmatic edges, and Maul ran through the wall, leapt over a chair in the next room, which fortunately for its tenants was deserted at the moment, and stabbed downward with one blade of his lightsaber, shearing a ragged oval in the floor. He dropped through the ceiling of the cubicle below just as the rocket struck the wall of the Nemoidian's room and exploded. Lin had never seen anybody move like the man with the horned and tattooed head. He wasn't dressed like a Jedi, but his expertise with the double-bladed lightsaber far exceeded the skill of any Jedi Lin had ever heard of. He knocked blaster bolts away as if swatting flies, and if he could do that, Lin couldn't stop him. He would use that double-bladed lightsaber to slice her apart. Desperate, she reached for her wrist launcher. Her only chance was to hit the horned one squarely and hope that the explosion would be contained enough by the other's body to allow Lin to survive. But as she triggered the launcher, the tattooed man seemed to disappear in a blur.
All of a sudden, there was a hole in the wall where an instant ago it had been solid. Too late, Lynn tried to stop the rocket from firing, but the reactionless motor flared and the missile leapt from her wrist. She tried to jump back into the hallway. Lorne was almost to the room where he was supposed to meet the Nemoidian when a sudden explosion hurled him backwards a good 3 meters, impacting against the wall of a T-intersection. As the shock wave lifted him, he caught a glimpse of what looked like an armored human flying across the hall just ahead of him and smashing halfway through the wall. Then he hit the far wall himself and didn't think about anything for a time. He was out for only a minute or two. When the corridor swam back into focus, the smoke was still swirling and debris was still settling. There was a ringing in his ears that was a result of either the blast or the dozens of residential alarms activated by it, or both. Lorne managed to get to his feet, pulled his blaster, and edged unsteadily forward. All he could see of the body was a pair of legs, unmistakably female, sticking out of a hole in the wall, so thinking of her as dead seemed a pretty safe bet. He turned and peered into the blackened cube. What looked like the remains of 4 bodies lay scorched and smoking on the floor. He took a few steps into the chamber. One of the smoldering corpses looked like Monchar, but it was hard to be sure, given that it was headless. Lorne felt his guts churn, both at what he saw and what it meant. Half Monchar wouldn't be making any more deals with anybody. He was quite seriously dead, and Lorne and I-5 might as well be too, if they didn't get off Coruscant in the next hour or so. The whole bank fraud escapade had been for nothing. Damn. Lorne turned to run. Even in this sector, an explosion like the one that had just happened would bring the security forces in to investigate. He had to get out of there, and fast. But as he started to move, he noticed a glimmer of light in a corner of the room and reflexively glanced at it. What he saw brought him skidding to a stop. Could it be? It seemed too much to hope for. But when he bent down and looked closer, he realized that maybe the game wasn't over yet. The holocron crystal lay in the half-open safe, which had no doubt protected it from being destroyed by the explosion. Lorne grabbed it up, holding it tightly in one hand and the blaster in the other, and now he did run, as fast as he could, down the corridor past the confused and frightened faces of tenants who had cautiously emerged to investigate, and toward the stairwell. There was still a chance, a very slim chance, that he and I-5 could yet turn this fiasco into a winning situation, but doing so meant getting far away from here as fast as possible. 11. The building Darsha had entered was a monad, a kilometer high, totally self-contained habitat. More than just an apartment complex, the huge structure, like countless others sprouting from the surface of Coruscant, contained virtually everything its tenants needed. Living quarters, shops, hydroponic gardens, and even indoor parks. Many people she knew literally lived their entire lives in buildings like these. In some cases, Hala commuting to offices halfway around the planet without ever venturing outside. She had never understood the attraction of such a life before. Now, however, she found herself in sympathy with such people in at least one respect. She had no desire to leave the building either, but her reluctance did not rise out of nascent agoraphobia. Rather, it stemmed from the fact that to leave meant returning to the Jedi Temple, where she would have to face the Council and admit her failure. However, there was no other alternative. The Council had to know of the Fondorian's death, and quickly. It was her duty to report her failure, no matter how shameful it was. She had to climb 4 more flights of stairs before she reached a level that had a working lift tube. This she took up another 10 levels, where she encountered a border checkpoint, complete with an armed guard droid, separating the down-levels ghetto from the functioning upper section of the monad. The droid eyed her disreputable appearance with some suspicion, but let her pass when it realized she was a Jedi. When Darsha emerged from the building, she was in a much more familiar world. She walked out onto a transparent sky bridge and looked down through the permacrete floor. The sleek sides of the buildings all around her fell away into darkness and fog. Beneath that fog was the abyss she had just escaped. If she was given a choice between returning to it or returning to the temple to admit her defeat, she honestly wasn't sure which she would take. But there was no choice, was there? Not really. She made her way to an air taxi stand, aware of the stares that her torn clothing and bandaged wounds drew.
Truly, I am still trapped between worlds, she thought.
Just enough credit was left on her emergency tab to hire an air taxi that would take her back to the temple. As Darsha settled into the vehicle's back seat, she felt suddenly overcome by lassitude. It was all she could do not to fall asleep as the taxi made its short journey. She recognized the drowsiness as not so much a reaction to the trials she had just undergone, but as an attempt to escape what lay ahead. All too soon the commute was over. Darsha paid the driver and entered the temple. As far back as she could remember, passing through the doors had been a source of comfort to her. It meant a return to sanctuary, to safety, to a place where the cares and worries of the rest of the world were left behind. She did not feel this way now. Now the high walls and soft lighting induced anxiety and claustrophobia. She shook her head and squared her shoulders. Might as well get it over with. At this time of day, she would most likely find Master Bandra in his quarters. She would report to her mentor first. Then, in all likelihood, they would both go to the council. Darth Maul had made an error. The enormity of that knowledge weighed upon him like a giant planetoid. He had underestimated the bounty hunter because the woman had not been strong in the Force. Such a mistake had almost cost him his life, and how ignominious would that have been to die at the hands of a common bounty hunter, he who had been trained to fight and slay Jedi. He could not make such dangerous assumptions. He would not make them again. He knew what his next move had to be. Hath Monchar was dead, but there was still the human to deal with. As Maul emerged from the building, the police and firefighting droids were already starting to arrive. He could not cloud the cognitive circuits of droids as easily as he could organic brains, and so he had to move quickly into the shadowy surface streets to avoid questioning. He found a deserted blind alley a few blocks away and activated his wrist comm. A moment later, the image of Darth Sidious appeared before him.
"Tell me what progress you have made," Sidious said. "The tergiversator Hath Monchar has been killed. He has shared his knowledge with one other. A human named Lorne Pavan. I know where the human lives. I go now to find him and kill him." "Excellent. Do so as quickly as possible. You are certain that no one else knows of this?" "Yes, Master. I..."
Maul stopped suddenly in shocked realization. The holocron. As always, Sidious immediately knew that something was wrong.
"What is it?" the Sith Lord demanded.
Darth Maul knew he would have to admit failure. He did not hesitate. The concept of lying to his master never even occurred to him.
"Monchar possessed a holocron that he said contains the information. I had an opportunity to acquire it, but I failed to do so."
It would be pointless to try to exculpate himself by telling Sidious of the bounty hunter's unexpected appearance and the subsequent explosion that he had barely escaped. The only important fact was that the holocron was not in his possession. Maul saw Darth Sidious's eyes narrow in disapproval.
"You disappoint me, Lord Maul."
He felt that censure spear him like an icy shaft. No trace of it showed on his face.
"I am sorry, my master." "Your tasks are now twofold. Destroy this Lorne Pavan and find the crystal." "Yes, my master."
Sidious regarded Maul steadily for a moment.
"Do not fail me again."
The hologram vanished. Darth Maul stood silently for a moment in the perennial darkness of the city's surface. His breathing was steady and even, his body motionless. Only one trained to sense the whorls and verticils of the Force would get a sense of the dark storm that raged within him. His master had rebuked him, and rightly so. That crystal could be the ruination of all Darth Sidious's carefully laid plans, and he, Darth Maul, heir to the Sith, had left it behind when he had fled for his life. Fool! Maul's nostrils flared as he drew in a deep, shuddering breath. He had no time for self-recrimination. The Nemoidian's cubicle was no doubt already overrun with police droids searching for a clue to the explosion. They would hardly overlook an information crystal lying in an open safe. There was, of course, the possibility that it had been destroyed in the explosion, but he couldn't count on that. He would have to go back and find out what had happened to it, even if every police droid on Coruscant was packed into that tiny room. and after he had found the holocron and disposed of the human, then he would have to face whatever punishment Darth Sidious would undoubtedly devise for his lamentable failure. Maul strode out of the alley and back toward the domicile. Lorne found I-5 just venturing into the first floor of the building, or trying to, as the stampede of panicked tenants had filled all the exits. Though the droid's metallic face was expressionless as always, he had somehow managed to project concern, followed by relief as he saw Lorne. "Let's get out of here," Lorne muttered to the droid. "Fast."
"That sounds like a remarkably astute idea." Walking quickly, they soon put several city blocks between themselves and the debacle. Then I-5 said, "It appears that all did not go entirely according to plan."
"Ever a master of the understatement."
Lorne explained what had happened.
"I have no idea who the dead woman was. I have no idea what caused the explosion. I have no idea who killed the Nemoidian and his goons. What I do have is this."
He pulled the holocron from a pocket. I-5 took it and looked closely at it.
"It appears to be encoded," the droid said. "It definitely contains some sort of information. Whether it's the details of the trade embargo of Naboo or a recipe for Alderaan stew is impossible to tell without activating it."
"It better well be what Monchar said it is."
Lorne glanced at his wrist chrono.
"We've got barely enough time to make the meeting with the hut and then get to the spaceport."
"I would predict another half hour or so of grace. Most of the local law enforcement will be more interested in the explosion than in catching us. Nevertheless, I agree that a hasty retreat is called for. I took the liberty of using our temporary wealth to secure two berths on the next spice transport bound for the rim. Once we have the money from the hut, we can pay the fare in cash."
Lorne nodded. I-5 was right. The important thing was to unload the holocron and get off-world as quickly as possible. It was likely that whoever had terminated Hath Monchar was looking for the crystal, and Lorne most definitely did not want to make his acquaintance. In his mind's eye, he could still vividly see the Nemoidian's headless body lying on the floor of the apartment, along with his bodyguards. One of them had been decapitated as well. He stopped abruptly, paralyzed by shock. I-5 looked at his face, then quickly dragged him out of the stream of foot traffic.
"What is it?"
"No blood," Lorne said.
I-5 said nothing. He waited.
"Whoever did Monchar cut off his head. One of the Quarren bodyguards got the same treatment. But there was no blood to speak of. You understand? No blood. That means..."
"Cauterization. Fusion of the tissues by sudden intense heat."
I-5 paused, and Lorne knew the droid had reached the same conclusion that he had.
"Perhaps a quick lateral movement of a blaster on continuous fire?"
"The particle beam from a hand blaster, even a DL-44, isn't that hot, and you know it. On a straight line, yeah, it can seal as it burns, but to cauterize something the size of a neck would take several seconds. It would have to have been done after Monchar was dead, and what's the sense of that?
There's only one weapon capable of doing it instantaneously. The same weapon that was used to cut the lock out of the Durasteel door."
"A lightsaber."
I-5 glanced about, as if to assure himself that no one was listening.
"Are you saying a Jedi killed Monchar?"
"Much as I hate to admit it, executions aren't their style."
Lorne's mouth was suddenly very dry. He had to swallow several times before he could continue.
"Which leaves only one other logical choice."
"The Sith?
Impossible. The last one died over 1,000 years ago."
"That's what everyone believes, but it's the only conclusion that makes any sense. The Jedi have kept the details of lightsaber manufacture secret for millennia. To create and use one, you have to be adept in the Force, and the Sith were the only other order of Force sensitives the galaxy has ever known."
"And why couldn't it just as easily be a rogue Jedi? One who has succumbed to some kind of psychosis, a failing organic beings are often prone to, I've noticed."
"I think you're jumping to conclusions," I-5 said.
"No, I'm not."
Lorne grabbed the droid and pulled him along as he started to walk faster.
I'm jumping on that spice transport and getting off this overbuilt rock, and so are you.
He spied a public trash disintegrator across the street and changed course, with I-5 still in tow.
And we're getting rid of this holocron right now.
They stopped before the disintegrator receptacle. Lorne pulled the information crystal from a pocket, but before he could throw it in, I-5 grabbed his arm.
"Now I know you're crazy," the droid said. "That holocron is our only chance to build a new life. And how will we pay our passage on the spice freighter? We can't just..."
Lorne shoved the droid up against the graffiti-frescoed wall of a large hydro-reclamation processor. Pedestrians of various and sundry species passed them, paying little or no attention to the altercation.
"Listen to me," Lorne said through clenched teeth. "If I'm right, there's a Sith out there. He's probably looking for this."
He held up the holocron.
"He can't be bought off, scared off, or thrown off the trail, and he'll stop at nothing to get it. I don't fancy having my neck cauterized."
"Let's say you're right," I-5 said. "Let's say Monchar's mysterious assassin is a Sith. Let's say he wants the crystal, and he knows we have it. Let's say he corners us before we reach the hut and demands we give it to him. Which will make him happier with us, handing him the crystal or telling him we destroyed it?"
Lorne paused, trying to quell his panic. He knew he wasn't using his brain, at least not the part parked directly behind his forehead. He was thinking with the organ's hindquarters, the primal fight-or-flight component. But fight-or-flight, or more precisely, just flight, was the only option that made any sense in this case. In his previous life, Lorne had researched the Sith thoroughly, and he knew they were fanatics pure and simple. If a Sith was on their trail, the only prudent thing to do was to put half a galaxy between them and their stalker as quickly as possible. Nevertheless, he had to admit that I-5's argument about keeping the holocron had a certain logic. After all, fencing it to the hut might be sufficient to throw the Sith off their trail. It was reasonable to assume he was after the holocron, not them. And all this was based on the assumption that Monchar's killer was in fact a Sith. It was a big galaxy, after all, and Coruscant was the biggest melting pot of all the inhabited worlds. It was possible that there existed someone, neither Jedi nor Sith, who had somehow gotten hold of a lightsaber and could make it work. After all, it probably didn't require being a master of the Force to simply slice an energy blade through someone's neck. But none of this made Lorne feel any easier. Neither he nor I-5 had managed to survive these past 4 years in the rancid underbelly of Coruscant by taking chances. As he had told the droid more than once, it wasn't a question of being paranoid. It was a question of being paranoid enough. Still, there wasn't a whole lot of choice. They could keep the holocron and stay on Coruscant in the hope that giving it up would dissuade Monchar's murderer from beheading them as well. Or they could sell it and use the credits to flee, and hope they were not pursued. Neither alternative seemed to offer much in the way of living to a ripe old age. Lorne sighed and released the droid. "All right," he said. "Let's go meet the hut."
12. Alone in his secret chambers, Darth Sidious meditated on this latest set of circumstances. In many ways, Darth Maul was an exemplary acolyte. His loyalty was unquestionable and unshakable. Sidious knew that, if he were to command it, Maul would sacrifice his life without a second's hesitation. And his skills as a warrior were nonpareil. Nevertheless, Maul had his flaws, and by far the largest of these was hubris. Though he had said nothing when given the assignment, Sidious knew Maul felt that such a job was beneath his skills. There were times, many times, when Sidious could see Maul's aura pulsing with the dark stain of impatience. He wondered sometimes if he had inculcated too much hatred of the Jedi and their ways in his apprentice. Maul did tend to focus on their destruction at the expense of the larger picture. Even so, Sidious had every confidence that Maul would accomplish the task he had been set. Complications and setbacks were to be expected and would be dealt with. All that mattered was the grand design, and it was proceeding apace. Soon the Jedi would be put to the slaughter. That should make his impetuous subordinate happy. Soon. Very soon.
Master Anun Bandara sat in silence for several minutes after Darsha finished her report. They were, quite possibly, the longest minutes of the Padawan's life. The Twi'lek Jedi sat with head bowed and fingers steepled, looking at the floor between them. There was no way to read his body language to tell what he was thinking. Even his leku were motionless. But Darsha had a pretty good idea that, whatever her mentor's thoughts were, they did not bode well for her continued career as a Jedi. At last, Master Bandara sighed and raised his gaze to meet Darsha's. "I am glad you are still alive," he said. And Darsha felt a surge of gratitude and love for her mentor that was almost overwhelming in its intensity. Her safety had been more important to Master Bandara than the mission. "Now tell me," the Twi'lek continued, "did you see the Fondorian die?" "No, but there was no way he could have survived such a fall." Master Bandara held up a hand to stop her. "You did not see him die, and I assume you did not feel any upheaval in the Force that could have meant his death." Darsha thought back to the nightmarish events of several hours previous. Scanning the waves of the Force for such a ripple of disturbance hadn't exactly been uppermost in her mind at that moment. Would she have felt such an agitation, preoccupied as she had been with trying to save her own life? Her mentor would have, of that she was sure. But was she that finely attuned to the Force? "I did not," she said slowly, then felt compelled to add, "but given the circumstances..." "The circumstances were hardly optimal, I'm sure," Master Bandara said. "But as long as the slightest chance exists that Ulth is still alive, we must pursue it. The information he had is that important." "You want me to go back and verify his death?" The thought of returning to the Crimson Corridor was enough to make her dizzy with revulsion. Nevertheless, if that was what had to be done, she would do it. Master Bandara stood, his attitude and posture decisive. "We shall go together. Come." He strode toward the door of his quarters, and Darsha hastened to follow. "But what about the Council? Should we not tell them?" The Jedi stopped before reaching the door and looked back at the Padawan. "Tell them what? There is nothing definitive to report as yet. Once we know for certain whether the Fondorian is alive or dead, then shall we make our report." He turned back to the panel, which slid open before him, and started down the corridor. Darsha followed, only gradually beginning to realize that there might be a chance, however infinitesimal, that her mission had not ended in failure. It was the lightest and most frangible of straws. Nevertheless, as long as it hovered before her, she could do nothing else but grasp at it. Maul kept his cowl up and his lightsaber clipped as he re-entered the building. Fortunately, there was a human officer at the checkpoint, asking those coming and going to state their business. It was ridiculously easy for Maul to cloak himself in the Force and thus slip by the dim-witted fellow. The forensics droids were laser-scanning the cubicle when he arrived. There were a couple of criminologists, one Maralsi and one Sulliston as well. He stayed in the hallway and listened to what scraps of conversation he could. He heard no mention of a holocron being found. Carefully, he probed and prodded first the Maralsi's mind, then the Sulliston's, and detected nothing about the crystal in their thoughts. Still cloaked in the dark side, he stole past the entrance of the cubicle, glancing at the open safe as he did so. The holocron was not there. Maul pondered the possibilities. If it was gone, then someone other than the security forces must have taken it. And who might that have been? Obviously, the buyer Monchar had been expecting momentarily the human known as Lorn Pavan. He was going to enjoy taking that one's head. Darth Maul turned and headed for the exit. Now he had a double incentive to find the human and his droid. The first place to check, of course, would be their pathetic subterranean cubicle. It was not far from here, only a few minutes' walk. Which, with any luck, would be the same few minutes Pavan had left of his life. On the whole, Lorne did not consider himself to be overly xenophobic. After all, given the way he had been making his living for the last half decade, to be prejudiced against other species was not only bad for business, it could be downright dangerous. But he hated dealing with huts.
On a purely physical level, everything about the giant invertebrates repulsed him. Their huge reptilian eyes, their slithering method of locomotion, and most of all, their slimy mucosal skin. Just having to be in a room with Yanth sent a wave of horripilation over him that was hard put to quell. Yanth was young as huts go, less than 500 standard years old. Even so, he was smart and cagey, and working his way up through the underworld ranks rapidly. Though Lorne could barely stand to be in the same room with the overgrown slug, he had to admit a reluctant admiration for the young hut's amoral cunning and craftiness. No one could figure the angles as quickly and completely as Yanth could. Now he reclined on a dais in his subterranean headquarters, desultorily puffing on a chakroot hookah while he examined the holocron crystal. A couple of Gamorrean guards stood nearby, watching Lorne and I-5.
"Why did you not go directly to the Jedi with this?" he asked Lorne, his rumbling basso profundo setting off unpleasant vibrations in the human's gut. "They would seem the logical ones to approach."
Lorne saw no reason to elaborate on his own personal distaste for the Jedi to Yanth. "They claim to have very little discretionary funds for this sort of thing," he said. "Besides, I wouldn't put it past them to use their mind tricks to force me into handing it over for free." He glanced surreptitiously at his chrono and said, "So, are you interested or not? I can always take it directly to the Naboo representative here on Coruscant." Yanth waved a pudgy hand in a placating gesture.
"Patience, my friend. Yes, I am interested. But, and please don't take this as a reflection on you, I would be a fool not to test its authenticity before handing you a stack of credits."
Lorne kept his face carefully expressionless. If Yanth suspected the time crunch they were in, the hut would have no compunctions about using it as leverage to gouge a cheaper price. On the other hand, time was most definitely running out. "And just how do you plan on doing that?" he asked the hut. Yanth simply smiled and slid several facets of the crystal aside at various angles, manipulating it much as one might a child's geometric puzzle. After a moment, a beam projected from the holocron's uppermost surface, resolving into a mid-air display of glowing words and images that slowly curtained up the length of the holographic frame before vanishing. Lorne was too far away to read the text. Not only that, but he was behind the display, so that the words and alphanumerics appeared reversed to him. The text seemed to be in Basic, however, and the images looked like schematics for Naboo N1 starfighters and Trade Federation ships. Yanth rotated a facet, and the images cut off.
"Opening one of these holocrons can be somewhat tricky," he said. "Nemoidians, as a species, are not overly clever."
I-5 said, "Excellent. Now you know the article is genuine. We are asking 1,000,000 credits."
"Done," Yanth replied, much to Lorne's surprise. "It is worth 10 times that."
The hut turned to a control console near at hand and pressed a button. Lorne permitted himself another glance at his timepiece. They could still reach the spaceport if everything continued to proceed smoothly. In another hour, Coruscant, the mysterious Sith killer, and the police would be vanishing into the void behind them. Darth Maul neatly and quickly excised the lock on the underground cubicle with one blade of his lightsaber, as he had earlier at Hath Monchar's building. He stepped inside quickly, letting the door slide closed behind him. Harsh glow lamps flickered on automatically, illuminating a living space even smaller and tawdrier than the one the Nemoidian had rented. The compartment was empty. The only possible place where someone might hide was the refresher, and it was the work of only a few seconds to make sure that was empty as well. Maul stepped to a section of wall that held a vid screen and message unit. He activated the latter. An image formed in midair, the image of a hut. He recognized the creature. Yanth, an up-and-coming gangster in the Black Sun organization, one of the few who had survived the slaughter Maul had recently unleashed. The hut's image spoke.
"Lorne, I thought we were going to meet sometime today to discuss a certain holocron you wished me to look at. It's not polite to keep buyers waiting, you know."
Maul turned and strode out of the cubicle, moving quickly.
13. All too soon, Darsha Asant found herself back in the underbelly of Coruscant. When she had escaped the area earlier that day, she had estimated that by now she would have been stripped of her rank and reassigned to the Agricultural Corps. She had envisioned herself in the process of packing her belongings and saying her goodbyes. That she might instead be returning to the scene of her disgrace with her mentor had certainly never occurred to her. And yet, here she was, seated beside a noon Bandara in the latter's four-person sky car, heading back toward the Crimson Corridor and the Monad where she had lost the Fondorian and nearly lost her life as well. The ways of the Force were nothing if not unpredictable. "That's the one," she said, pointing toward the tower that rose up ahead, stark against the afternoon sun. "Down there." Master Bandara said nothing as he angled the sky car out of the flow of traffic. They slipped into a vertical descent lane and began dropping. The mist that seemed always present around the 100-meter mark, demarcating the thriving upper levels from the slums below, wrapped around them momentarily and then faded away, to be replaced with an aerial view of the dark streets. Though it was still daylight above, down here it was at best a dim, perpetual twilight. She watched the wall of the building slip past and pointed out to her mentor the ascension gun's grapnel still hooked to a ledge. They followed the cable into the miasmic depths. When they were 10 meters above the pavement, Master Bandara turned on the landing lights. The section of street below them was illuminated. Darsha, looking over the side, could see shadowy figures, long conditioned to prefer darkness to light, scuttling away. There was no sign of the Fondorian. In all probability, his body had been dragged away by scavengers. There was, however, a smear of purplish blood on the pavement, and nearby the body of a hawk bat, its neck broken in the fall. Master Bandara trained one of the lights on that and looked at it. His leku slumped slightly along with his shoulders. And watching him, Darsha realized that her last hope of salvaging the mission was finally, irrevocably dead.
"What shall we do now?" she asked him softly.
He was silent for a long moment. Then he sighed and said, "Return to the temple. We must report what has happened to the council." So there it was, she thought. Oddly enough, now that she knew hope was dead, she did not feel the crushing sorrow that she had anticipated. Instead, she felt a surprising sense of relief. The worst had happened, and now she would find a way to deal with it. As with most looming disasters, the reality was almost anticlimactic compared to the dreadful anticipation. Up to this point, her concern about the mission had left little room for her to feel sympathy for Ulth the Fondorian. Now, however, looking at the stain of his blood on the walkway, she felt compassion well within her. He had been an obnoxious poltroon, and no doubt a conscienceless criminal, but few people deserved a death as horrible as his had been. Master Bandara fed power to the repulsors, and the sky car began to rise. Lorne watched as one of the hut's flunkies delivered a large case to his master. Yanth opened it, and Lorne grew dizzy at the sight. It was filled with crisp Republic credit standards in 1,000 denomination notes. Yanth turned the case toward him, displaying the wealth, and Lorne could feel his fingers twitching with the desire to take possession of it. He hadn't seen that much hard cash in... He had never seen that much cash in one place before. 1,000,000 non-sequential Republic credits, Yanth said, as casually as if he was discussing the weather. You take them. I keep this. He held up the holocron. Everybody's happy. Lauren didn't know or care about everybody, but he was sure of one thing. He was happy. He watched, still hardly able to believe this was happening, as I-5 stepped forward to take possession of the money that would transform their lives. He glanced at his chrono, just enough time to get to the spaceport if they left now. I-5 was reaching for the case when the door behind them suddenly flew open. A Cheevan bodyguard staggered backwards into Yanth's sanctum, a force pike dropping from his nerveless fingers. It clattered across the floor to the foot of the dais. The leathery-skinned being looked down at his chest, in the middle of which was a smoking hole, and then collapsed. Through the door stepped a nightmare. Lorne stared in shock at the apparition.
The Cheevan's killer was almost 2 meters tall and dressed entirely in black, including hooded cloak, boots, and heavy gauntlets. He carried a lightsaber unlike any Lorne had ever seen. It boasted not one but two energy blades emanating from either end of the hilt. But as intimidating as his weapon was, it was his face that struck true horror into Lorne's heart. The killer pulled back his hood, revealing a countenance that was a sinister variegation of red and black tattoos around gleaming yellow eyes and blackened teeth. From the bald scalp sprouted 10 short horns, like a demonic crown. He stared balefully at the others in the room, then spoke in a guttural voice.
None shall survive.
Lorne was completely frozen to the spot, unable to offer any resistance as the killer stepped toward him. His eyes shone like twin suns as he raised the lightsaber. I-5 grabbed the case full of money from Yanth and hurled it between Lorne and his attacker, just as the latter swung the lightsaber in a flat arc that would have separated the Corellian's head from his neck. The case intercepted the blade's swing. The plasmatic edge sliced through the case, scattering burning credits everywhere. The force of the blow was so strong that it probably would have decapitated Lorne, but its momentum was slowed just enough to give the droid time to dive forward, knocking his friend out of harm's way. Lorne felt the heat as the blade's incandescent tip seared through his hair. The Sith, for there was no doubt in Lorne's mind that he was facing one of those legendary dark lords out of the mists of the past, recovered almost instantly and swung around to attack again. But by this time, both Gamorrean guards had pulled their blasters and were firing. The Sith spun the double-bladed weapon before him, deflecting the blaster fire back at the guards. That was all Lorne had time to see before I-5 yanked him to his feet and pulled him through the doorway. They fled down the narrow corridor that led from Yanth's sanctum, passing several more dead guards and two piles of melted, twisted metal that had once been droids. Yanth's headquarters was beneath a nightclub he owned called the Tuscan Oasis. Lorne and I-5 stumbled up a short flight of stairs and burst out into a blue-lit chamber full of sabacc tables, degeric game boards, and scantily clad females of various species dancing on pedestals. They hurtled through the room and out the entrance. "Where are we going?" Lorne shouted as they ran down the street. "Away from there," I-5 shouted back. Lorne wanted to protest that it wouldn't make any difference. He had looked into the eyes of the Sith, and he had seen his doom there as plainly as the tattooed worlds that surrounded those eyes. An implacable fate that would hunt him down, no matter how far and how fast he ran. But he had no breath in him to speak, no breath left for running either. But the fear of what he had seen in those eyes kept him running anyway. Maul saw his quarry slip past him, but he could do nothing to stop their flight while his attention was occupied by the two Gamorreans. Using one hand to spin the lightsaber in a blazing pattern that blocked the particle beam bursts, he gestured with his free hand, plucking the invisible lines of the Force and sending reverberations that caused the blasters to fly from the surprised guards' grips. Before they had time to recover from their surprise, Maul leapt forward, skewering first one and then the other with quick, deadly thrusts. The lifeless Gamorrean sagged to the floor, and Maul wheeled quickly about to deal with the hut. Despite his bulk, Yanth could move quickly when he had to. He slithered off the dais and grabbed up the Force pike dropped by the Cheevan. He hurled it at Maul, who slashed it in two with a sweep of his own weapon. The generator in the pike's shaft shorted out in a shower of sparks. Yanth had not waited to see the results of his attack. His massive bulk moved rapidly, slithering through the singed and blackened credit notes that littered the floor, the holocron crystal still clutched in one hand. He had almost reached the exit when Maul leapt, executing a twisting forward flip that covered the length of the large chamber and deposited him directly in front of the hut. Before Yanth could recover from his surprise, Darth Maul plunged one of the lightsaber's blades deep into the hut's chest. The stench of burning flesh and blubber filled the room. Yanth died with a croaking gurgle, the gelid mass of his body sagging bonelessly to the floor. Maul deactivated both blades. He reached out with his free hand, and the holocron leapt from the dead hut's grasp into his own. Stuffing it into a belt compartment, he turned and ran from the room. At the top of the stairs, he plunged recklessly through the gambling chamber, hurtling guests and workers aside with savage force-laden gestures.
He reached the street and paused, looking first one way, then another for his prey. Pavan and the droid were not in sight. Maul gritted his teeth. They would not be permitted to slip away again. One way or another, he was determined to end this chore. It had already gone on far too long. He sought the dark side once more, bade it illuminate the path his quarry had taken. Then he began to move, shoving his way through the hapless press of street people. Though his appearance alone was enough to cause most of the hard cases on the street to give him a wide berth, his progress was still too slow. Enough of this, Maul thought. He unleashed the dark side, using the force like a battering ram against those who got in his way. Maul angled to the middle of the narrow avenue. His speeder bike was parked not far away. He could activate the slave's circuit by remote control and have it here within a few minutes at most. But there was an even quicker way to overtake them. He called upon the force, moving easily 5 times faster than a human could travel at a dead run. There was no way they could escape him now. Within moments, he was in sight of his quarry. Another few seconds, and he would catch up to them. And then the lightsaber would do its work once more, slashing through metal and flesh, and at last bringing this dreary task to an end. He grinned and lengthened his gargantuan stride even further, sailing over the fire-blackened husk of a parked land speeder. Pavan and the droid looked back and saw him coming. He could see the fear in the human's face. It was most satisfying to witness. One more leap, and both of them would be his. And then an invisible hammer struck him in mid-leap, pounding him to the ground. What was this? Who dared to interfere? Maul looked up, saw a sky car settling to the ground alongside Pavan and the droid. The repulsor beams from its undercarriage had struck him down when the vehicle passed directly over him. The sky car was less than 5 meters away. He could see the driver and his passenger clearly. They were Jedi. 14. Darsha had sensed the disturbance in the Force at the same time as Master Bondura. They had almost reached the cloud level when they felt the dark vibrations from below. They stared at each other simultaneously in shock, and then the Twi'lek put the sky car in a steep dive back down toward the street. Neither spoke. Darsha wasn't sure how the blast of hatred and destruction reverberating from below had affected her mentor, but she had been left shaken and nauseated by the intensity of the empathic burst. Someone down there was well-versed in the use of the Force, and powerful to boot. There had been several deaths already, and more intended, no question about it. She didn't know who had died or who was in danger, but they could not ignore such a strong and savage use of the Force. They had to find out who was responsible and stop him, her, or it, if they could. Master Bondura leveled off at 20 meters above street level, moving as fast as was prudent through the urban maze. The sky car's headlights illuminated the narrow thoroughfare, and as they rounded a corner, they saw, perhaps 100 meters ahead, the one who had to be responsible for the pulsation they had felt. A tall biped in dark robes, covering ground in a series of gigantic strides that had to be force-assisted. Who or what could he be? Not a Jedi, that much was certain. He wielded the Force with the surety of a master, but no Jedi ever gave off such darksome emanations. There was only one explanation, but even as the thought occurred to her, Darsha felt her mind flinching away from it. It couldn't be. It was impossible. She had no time to wonder about it. Up ahead, they could see the two who were the Dark One's targets. That much would be obvious from their terror-stricken flight. The Dark One would reach his prey in one more gargantuan leap. Darsha could think of only one way to stop him, and it was evident from the direction in which Master Bondura was taking the sky car that he had thought of the same tactic. The sky car passed right over the robed figure at a height carefully calculated to deliver a force from the repulsors sufficient to stun but not kill. It worked. As the vehicle lurched and moved on, Darsha looked behind them and saw the mysterious assailant lying in the street, the fuliginous robes a darker blot against the general darkness. Then Master Bondura brought the sky car to a stop near the two fugitives. Darsha noted with surprise that one of them was a droid. "Get in," Master Bondura said to the human. "He's unconscious, but I don't know how long he'll be." "Not long," the droid said and pointed back toward the pursuer. Darsha glanced back and saw to her astonishment that the Dark One was already rising to his feet.
She could scarcely believe he had recovered from the repulsor's hammering so fast. "Get in," Master Bondra shouted. "Now!"
The human, who had been staring at Darsha and her mentor with a strange expression, mingled relief and revulsion, seemed to wisely decide that they were by far the lesser of two evils. He vaulted into the sky car's back seat, followed by the droid. Darsha cast another glance behind her and saw the Dark One leaping toward them. This close, she could see his face, and a more fearsome visage she could not recall ever having encountered. Then her neck was jerked painfully as Master Bondra hit the ascent control and the sky car rocketed upward. But not swiftly enough. The vehicle shuddered from a blow delivered to the stern undercarriage and then lurched to one side. As Master Bondra fought the controls, Darsha saw a black-gloved hand catch the cockpit's rear gunwale. He must have used the Force to help him jump, she thought, as the sky car was already a good 10 meters off the ground. Even as the thought went through her mind, she thrust out both hands in a pushing gesture, hurling an invisible but nonetheless powerful blow concentrated at that hand. It lost its grip, and the craft jerked again as the Dark One fell back to the street. "Let's get back up levels," she shouted. But even as the words left her, she saw the look on Master Bondra's face. "We can't," he said. Darth Maul's fury at seeing Pavan and his droid snatched from his clutches yet again was almost mitigated by the realization that the Jedi had entered the picture. Finally, a foe that might be worthy of his attention, someone who could truly test his mettle. Shrugging off the effects of the repulsor field, he charged after the rising sky car, igniting his lightsaber and slashing at the drive mechanism that made up part of the vehicle's undercarriage. His blow did some damage, that he could tell by the way the craft pitched to one side. Gathering the Force around him, Maul leapt and managed to seize the gunwale with one hand. Before he could heave himself into the cockpit, however, he felt the younger Jedi strike out at him with considerable power, enough to cause him to lose his hold and plummet back to the street. He landed lightly, the Force cushioning his fall. Even before his boots touched the ground, he had his wrist comm activated and was speaking into it the code command that would activate his speeder bike and bring it homing in on his signal. As he did this, he watched the sky car stabilize and then shoot forward. In the space of a second, it had rounded a corner and disappeared from view. No matter, he told himself as he awaited the speeder bike's arrival. The sky car would be easy enough to track via the Force, especially with a Jedi on board. Pavan and his droid had had more than their share of luck this day, but now their luck had most definitely run out.
"The vertical adjustment on the repulsor array has been damaged," the Jedi piloting the craft said.
"What does that mean?" the woman asked. She was younger than her companion, younger than Lorne, too.
"It means," I-5 said before the Jedi could answer, "that while we can move laterally and ascend, we can't rise above this level."
Lorne glanced over the side. It was hard to estimate their altitude in the pervasive gloom, but it looked to him that they were about 20 meters above the street. The sky car was moving at a fast clip. There was little air traffic at this level, which was fortunate, given the limited room for maneuverability granted by the narrow, twisting streets. He looked at the Jedi. He was a Twi'lek who appeared to be in his mid to late 40s. Lorne could not recall having seen him around the temple. Of course, that meant nothing. There were plenty of Jedi with whom he had had little or no contact. The irony of it all would have made him laugh if it wasn't still so blasted terrifying. To be rescued from the deadly grasp of a Sith by a Jedi. Still, he had to admit it was providential that they had come along when they did. Still, it looked like he and I-5 wouldn't be heading off-world any time soon. The Jedi Temple was probably the safest place for them now, though it galled him to admit that even to himself. So much had happened within the last few minutes, and practically all of it disastrous, that he hadn't even begun to come to grips with it yet. The Jedi shot around another corner, and Lorne felt inertia press his body against the low-powered tractor field designed to prevent injury in the case of accidents. "Take it easy," he said. "There's no way he can catch up with us on foot now."
"He's not on foot," the woman said tensely.
Darth Maul leapt onto the speeder bike as it flashed past him. He wrapped both hands around the acceleration grips on the handlebar and opened them up. The repulsor engine's hum climbed as the speeder shot forward.
Maul leaned into the turns as the speeder zoomed around corners. There was no need to activate the heads-up tracking display. The Jedi and his quarry gleamed like twin beacons in his mind. He could feel them in the sky car ahead of him. The speeder bike was moving at half again their speed. He would overtake them in mere minutes. Maul grinned savagely. It would be the work of a moment to dispose of Pavan and the droid. Then he would see just how good the Jedi were. It had been far too long since he had felt his lightsaber clash against another, had heard the grating scream of energy blades in conflict, had smelled the ozone tang. Far too long. "Why is the Sith after you?" Master Bondera shouted over the slipstream's howl. Though Darsha had come to the same conclusion, it was still shocking on a very deep level to hear Master Bondera articulate her thoughts. She had learned much about the Sith during her studies, of course, but all of the lectures and data seemed unanimous in the conclusion that the ancient Dark Order was no more. And yet, what else could he be, this creature of the night who even now pursued them? He was adept in the use of the Force, but it was quite obvious he was not a Jedi. That didn't leave a whole lot of choices. She saw the human and the droid look at each other and realized they had come to a silent agreement about something. Then the droid spoke. "We are information brokers," he said, and something, or rather the absence of something, in the timbre of his voice surprised Darsha. She could hear none of the built-in obsequiousness that droids, particularly those of the Protocol series, evidenced as a rule. He had a confidence in his tone and manner that was startling enough for her to notice, even given the duress of the moment. "I am known as I-5, and my associate is Lorne Pavan," the droid continued. Darsha saw Master Bondera glance quickly at Pavan and then return his attention to piloting. "He knows the name," she thought. "We were recently contacted by a Nemoidian named Hath Manchar, who wished to sell us a holocron containing details of a trade embargo to be imposed on the planet Naboo by the Trade Federation." Master Bondera said nothing in reply for a moment. Then he asked, "Is this in retaliation for the new tax recently imposed by the Republic Senate on the Trade Federation?" "Yes," Pavan replied. "The Federation fears the new tax will cut into their profits." "Naboo is highly dependent on imports to maintain its way of life," Master Bondera said. "Such sanctions could prove devastating to its people." He steered the sky car around another corner. Pedestrians, knowing the potential danger from the repulsor beams of a vehicle traveling this low, scattered left and right. "That doesn't explain why the Sith is trying to kill you," Master Bondera continued. Darsha admired the Jedi's equanimity. He might have been having this conversation in one of the quiet, comfortable reading chambers of the temple instead of in a damaged sky car traveling a dangerous route at maximum velocity. "You can see why the Nemoidians don't want this information to get out," I-5 said. "We're not sure why or how the Sith are involved, but Hath Manchar was killed by the one who's now pursuing us." "What happened to the holocron?" Darsha asked. "We were in the process of selling it to a hut named Yanth," Pavan replied, "when the Sith broke in. My guess is that the hut is dead, and the Sith either destroyed the crystal or has it with him." "This information must be brought to the Council immediately," Master Bondera said. "You two will be kept safe until the threat of the Sith has been dealt with." Darsha glanced at Lorne Pavan and saw a mingled frustration and resignation in his expression. "Jedi," he muttered to himself. "Why did it have to be Jedi?" She looked behind them. Their circuitous route had brought them into a somewhat less dark area of the city now, and she could plainly make out the shape of a speeder bike behind them. Even without the Force to confirm it, she would have been sure that it was the Sith pursuing them. "Here he comes," she said. "He's gaining fast." She saw that Pavan's face had gone pale, but that he didn't seem to be panicking. Good. The last thing they needed to deal with was another Ulth the Fondorian. She looked at Master Bondera and saw his jaw muscles clench in determination. "Take the controls," he told her. His order surprised her, but his tone of voice brooked no questioning. She slid over as Master Bondera pushed himself up and back,
then swung his feet over the back of the padded crossbar, separating the front and rear seats. She looked at the rear vid screen and saw that the Sith was not more than 5 meters behind her. He drew his lightsaber, activating the twin crimson beams. "Get them back to the temple," Master Bondura shouted at her. Then, before Darsha could even realize what he intended, much less protest or try to stop him, the Jedi stood up on the rear seat between Pavan and I-5. He activated his lightsaber, took 2 steps up onto the rear engine compartment, and leapt from the speeding sky car. 15. The Twi'lek Jedi's leap, guided by the Force, landed him squarely behind Maul on the rear engine housing of the T-shaped bike. The action took Maul by surprise. He had not expected such a courageous, if foolhardy, deed. Unexpected as the move was, however, Maul was still able to block the slash of the other's lightsaber with his own energy blade. He quickly activated the speeder's autopilot, then twisted around in the saddle, thrusting his weapon at the Jedi's chest. The Jedi blocked the blow and countered with another. Maul knew the battle could not continue this way. The speeder bike's autopilot was not sophisticated enough to chart a safe course at high speed through the torturous windings of the surface streets. He grabbed the handlebar and jerked the speeder toward a docking platform on a nearby building about 30 meters above the street. They shot by the sky car, which had slowed after the Jedi left it, and rose toward the shelf. As the ledge came within range of the autopilot sensors, the speeder slowed, then settled down to a landing on the extruded slab of ferrocrete. The Sith and the Jedi leapt from the speeder bike onto the platform to continue their battle. The docking ledge was only about 10 meters by 15, barely enough room to maneuver in. Maul knew he had to dispatch the Jedi quickly before Pavan once again vanished into the labyrinth of Coruscant's down levels. He pressed the attack viciously, blocking and thrusting, the twin radiant blade spinning a web of light about him. The Jedi was obviously a master of the Taras Kasi fighting arts as well, judging by the smooth way he parried and counterattacked. Still, within the first few moments of the engagement, Darth Maul knew that he himself was the superior fighter. He could tell that the Jedi knew it too, but Maul also knew that it didn't matter. The Jedi was committed to stopping the Sith, or at the very least, slowing him down enough to let the others get away, even if it meant giving his own life to do so. Maul bared his teeth. He would not lose his quarry again. He doubled his efforts, pressing the attack hard, hammering away at the Twi'lek's defenses. The Jedi gave ground, but Maul was still unable to slash through his guard. Then he heard something, the distinctive sound of the sky car's damaged engine. He let his awareness expand on the ripples of the Force, and what he sensed brought a dark smile of satisfaction to his face. The sky car, with his prey, was returning. Darsha could not believe it at first when Master Bondura leapt from the sky car onto the Sith speeder bike. Her first action was reflexive. She slowed the sky car, intending to go to her mentor's aid. "What are you doing?" Pavan shouted. "He said head for the temple." "I'm not going to abandon him to that monster," Darsha shouted back. She saw the speeder bike shoot past them, then rise and head for a docking ledge that protruded from a dilapidated building. "He knows what he's doing," the droid told her. "Are you prepared to make his sacrifice meaningless?" Darsha knew the droid's words made sense, but she didn't care. After all, she had made one mistake after another in the past several hours. Why stop now? She had gone far past the point of worrying about the consequences of her actions. All she knew was that she could not leave Master Bondura to battle the Sith alone. It was hard for her to conceive of a situation in which her mentor could be bested in combat, but if anyone was capable of it, she had the feeling the Sith was that one. She slowed the sky car and brought it around, heading back toward the landing ledge, and realized she had a problem. The damaged repulsor array had fixed the vehicle's ceiling, and the platform was a good 10 meters above them. Her ascension gun was still, as far as she knew, attached to the monad, nearly a kilometer from her present position. It would be no problem to leap 10 meters straight up. In training exercises, she had used the Force to help her perform jumps higher than that. To assay such a leap onto a narrow platform and into the midst of a raging lightsaber duel was a considerably more complex undertaking, however. It would do Master Bondura no good for her to get herself killed by the Sith.
Still, there was no other choice. Her mentor might sense the sky car's presence and leap back into it, but there was no guarantee he would be able to do so in the heat of battle. Darsha brought the sky car to a hovering stop below and to one side of the ledge. Above her, the two dueling figures were hidden by the ferrocrete slab, but she could see the variegated flashes and hear the angry buzzing and screeching of the lightsabers as they clashed. She had to take action now. She stood, pulled her lightsaber from its belt hook, and prepared to leap. And the world suddenly dissolved in a burst of blinding light and a deafening roar. Darth Maul had seen the grim realization in the eyes of his foe, the knowledge that the Twi'lek could not defeat his adversary. Once defeat was conceded in the mind, its reality was inevitable. It was only a matter of time. He pressed his attack to an even higher intensity, driving the Jedi back toward his speeder bike, intending to pin him between the dual-bladed lightsaber and the bike. With his movements thus constricted, it would be mere moments before the Twi'lek's tentacled head was separated from his neck. But then he saw the desperation in the other's face suddenly give way to realization and then to triumph. Quickly, before Maul could intuit what was intended, the Jedi whirled toward the speeder bike, raised his lightsaber, and plunged it to the hilt into the bike's repulsor drive housing. Maul realized his suicidal intention, but too late. The superheated energy blade melted with lightning swiftness through the housing and sank into the bike's power cell core. Maul turned and leapt from the platform, reaching for the dark side, enfolding himself in it, even as the power cell exploded, the heat and pressure wave vaporizing the Jedi in a microsecond, and then expanding, reaching hungrily for him as well. The landing platform shielded the sky car from the main force of the explosion. Otherwise, the three passengers would not have survived. Even so, the shockwave hurled Darsha from her standing position back over the rear of the craft. She would have plunged to the street below had Lorne not grabbed her wrist as she fell past him. I-5 lunged for the controls and fought to stabilize the vehicle, which was pitching and yawing wildly. For an instant that felt like an eternity, Darsha hung over the abyss, too stunned to use the force to help lift herself to safety. And then Lorne managed to pull her back into the rear seat compartment. But the danger was not yet over. The explosion had caused the platform to break free of its supports. It began to collapse, sagging away from the building wall. As it did so, Darsha caught a glimpse of the Sith's dark form hurtling from the ledge into the darkness below. The buckling platform clipped the sky car's side, sending it spinning out of control toward the street as well. I-5 fought with the controls and managed to level out as the vehicle reached the ground. The spectators, drawn to the scene by the explosion, scattered in panic as the sky car pancaked to a rough landing. Darsha, half-stunned, was vaguely aware of an insistent beeping that was rising in frequency and tone. Even as realization of what the beeping signified penetrated her dazed brain, she felt herself seized in a powerful grip and pulled from the wrecked sky car. As she stumbled across the litter-strewn pavement, she realized the droid was dragging her and Lorne Pavan away from the vehicle.
"Hurry," she mumbled. "Power cells on overload."
"A fact of which I am quite aware," I-5 replied. He stopped before a kiosk. A sign on the door read, "Keep out," in basic, but the droid ignored this and blasted the lock with a laser beam that shot from his left index finger. Within the kiosk was a narrow, dimly lit stairwell. The three of them hurried down it as, behind them, the alarm beeps reached a crescendo. A moment later, a second, more powerful explosion rocked the area. Darsha felt the stairwell shift and shudder as if in the throes of a trembler. The light went out, she felt herself falling, and then she knew no more.
End of Star Wars. Darth Maul, Shadow Hunter. Part 1 of 2. Restored and remastered by The.Archivist Publishing. If you have not yet subscribed to my channel, please take a moment to do so. There is so much more exciting Star Wars content on the way.